Recorded Books presents The Covenant of Water by Abraham Verghese, narrated by the author.
For Mariam Verghese, in memoriam. And a river went out of Eden to water the garden. Genesis 2:10. Not hammer strokes, but dance of the water sings the pebbles into perfection. Rabindranath Tagore. Part 1. Chapter 1. Always. 1900, Travancore, South India. She is 12 years old and she will be married in the morning. Mother and daughter lie on the mat, their wet cheeks glued together. "The saddest day of a girl's life is the day of her wedding," her mother says. "After that, God willing, it gets better." Soon she hears her mother's sniffles change to steady breathing, then to the softest of snores, which in the girl's mind seem to impose order on the scattered sounds of the night, from the wooden walls exhaling the day's heat to the scuffing sound of the dog in the sandy courtyard outside. A brain fever bird calls out, "Kerkada, Kerkada, which way is east? Which way is east?" She imagines the bird looking down at the clearing where the rectangular thatched roof squats over their house. It sees the lagoon in front and the creek and the paddy field behind. The bird's cry can go on for hours, depriving them of sleep, but just then it is cut off abruptly as though a cobra has snuck up on it. In the silence that follows, the creek sings no lullaby, only grumbling over the polished pebbles. She awakes before dawn while her mother still sleeps. Through the window, the water in the paddy field shimmers like beaten silver. On the front veranda, her father's ornate charu kasera, or lounging chair, sits forlorn and empty. She lifts the writing pallet that straddles the long wooden arms and seats herself. She feels her father's ghostly impression preserved in the cane weave. On the banks of the lagoon, four coconut trees grow sideways, skimming the water as if to preen at their reflections before straightening to the heavens. "Goodbye, lagoon. Goodbye, creek."
"Mole,"
her father's only brother had said the previous day, to her surprise. Of late, he wasn't in the habit of using the endearment "mole," daughter, with her.
"We found a good match for you."
His tone was oily, as though she were 4, not 12.
"Your groom values the fact that you're from a good family, a priest's daughter."
She knew her uncle had been looking to get her married off for a while, but she still felt he was rushing to arrange this match. What could she say? Such matters were decided by adults. The helplessness on her mother's face embarrassed her. She felt pity for her mother when she so wanted to feel respect. Later, when they were alone, her mother said,
"Mole, this is no longer our house. Your uncle..."
She was pleading as if her daughter had protested. Her words had trailed off, her eyes darting around nervously. The lizards on the walls carried tails.
"How different from here can life be there? You'll feast at Christmas, fast for Lent, church on Sundays, the same Eucharist, the same coconut palms and coffee bushes. It's a fine match. He's of good means."
Why would a man of good means marry a girl of little means, a girl without a dowry? What are they keeping secret from her? What does he lack? Youth, for one. He's 40. He already has a child. A few days before, after the marriage broker had come and gone, she overheard her uncle chastise her mother, saying,
"So what if his aunt drowned? Is that the same as a family history of lunacy? Who ever heard of a family with a history of drownings? Others are always jealous of a good match, and they'll find one thing to exaggerate."
Seated in his chair, she strokes the polished arms and thinks for a moment of her father's forearms. Like most Malayali men, he'd been a lovable bear, hair on arms, chest, and even his back, so one never touched skin except through soft fur. on his lap in this chair, she learned her letters. When she did well in the church school, he said, "You have a good head, but being curious is even more important. High school for you, college too, why not? I won't let you marry young like your mother." The bishop had posted her father to a troubled church near Mundakayam that had no steady achan because the Mohammedan traders had caused mischief. It wasn't a place for family, with morning mist still nibbling at the knees at midday and rising to the chin by evening, and where dampness brought on wheezing, rheumatism, and fevers. Less than a year into his posting, he returned with teeth-chattering chills, his skin hot to the touch, his urine running black. Before they could get help, his chest stopped moving. When her mother held a mirror to his lips, it didn't mist. Her father's breath was now just air. That was the saddest day of her life. How could marriage be worse? She rises from the cane seat for the last time. Her father's chair and his teak platform bed inside are like a saint's relics for her. They retain the essence of him, if only she might take them to her new home. The household stirs. She wipes her eyes, squares her shoulders, lifts her chin, lifts it to whatever this day will bring, to the unloveliness of parting, to leaving her home, that is home no longer. The chaos and hurt in God's world are unfathomable mysteries. Yet the Bible shows her that there is order beneath. As her father would say, faith is to know the pattern is there, even though none is visible. "I'll be all right, Appa," she says, picturing his distress. If he were alive, she wouldn't be getting married today. She imagines his reply. "A father's worries end with a good husband. I pray he's that. But this I know, the same God who watched over you here will be with you there, Mole." He promises this in the Gospels. "I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Chapter 2. To Have and to Hold. 1900, Travancore, South India. The journey to the groom's church takes almost half a day. The boatman steers them down a maze of unfamiliar canals overhung by flaming red hibiscus. The house is so close to the edge she could touch a squatting old woman winnowing rice with flicks of a flat basket. She can hear a boy reading the Manorama newspaper to a sightless ancient who rubs his head as if the news hurt. House after house, each a little universe, some with children her age watching them pass. "Where are you going?" asks a bare-chested busybody through black teeth, his black index finger, his toothbrush, covered in powdered charcoal, frozen in midair. The boatman glares at him. Out from the canals now onto a carpet of lotus and lilies, so thick she could walk across it. The flowers are opened like well-wishers. Impulsively, she picks one blossom, grabbing the stem anchored deep down. It comes free with a splash, a pink jewel. A miracle that something so beautiful can emerge from water so murky. Her uncle looks pointedly at her mother, who says nothing, though she worries that her daughter will dirty her white blouse and mundu or the kavani with faint gold trim. A fruity scent fills the boat. She counts 24 petals. Pushing through the lotus carpet, they emerge onto a lake so wide that the far shore is invisible, the water still and smooth. She wonders if the ocean looks like this. She has almost forgotten that she's about to marry. At a busy jetty, they transfer to a giant canoe pulled by lean, muscled men, its ends curled up like dried bean pods. 24 passengers stand in the middle, umbrellas countering the sun. She realizes that she's going so far away, it won't be easy for her to visit home again. The lake imperceptibly narrows to a broad river. The boat picks up speed as the current seizes it. At last, in the distance, up on a rise, a massive stone crucifix stands watch over a small church, its arms casting a shadow over the river. This is one of the 7.5 churches founded by St. Thomas after his arrival. Like every Sunday school child, she can rattle off their names. Kodungalur, Paravur, Niranam, Palayur, Nilakal, Kokamangalam, Kolam, and the tiny half-church in Thiruvadamkord. But seeing one for the first time leaves her breathless. The marriage broker from Randi paces up and down in the courtyard. Damp spots at the armpits of his juba connect over his chest.
The groom should have been here long before, he says.
The strands of hair he stretches over his dome have collapsed back over his ear like a parrot's plume. He swallows nervously and a rock moves up and down in his neck. The soil in his village famously grows both the best paddy and these goiters. The groom's party consists of just the groom's sister, Pangama. This sturdy, smiling woman grabs her future sister-in-law's tiny hands in both of hers and squeezes them with affection. He's coming, she says. The Achan slips the ceremonial stole over his robes and ties the embroidered girdle. He holds out his hand, palm up, to wordlessly ask, well? No one responds. The bride shivers, even though it is sultry. She isn't used to wearing a chata and mundu. From this day on, no more long skirt and colored blouse. She'll dress like her mother and aunt in this uniform of every married woman in the St. Thomas Christian world, white its only color. The mundu is like a man's, but tied more elaborately, the free edge pleated and folded over itself three times, then tucked into a fantail to conceal the shape of the wearer's bottom. Concealment is also the goal of the shapeless, short-sleeved V-neck blouse, the white chata. Light from the high windows slices down, casting oblique shadows. The incense tickles her throat. As in her church, there are no pews, just rough choir carpet on red oxide floors, but only in the front. Her uncle coughs. The sound echoes in the empty space. She'd hoped her first cousin, also her best friend, would come for the wedding. She had married the year before, when she was also 12, to a 12-year-old groom from a good family. At the wedding, the boy groom had looked as dull as a bucket, more interested in picking his nose than in the proceedings. The Achan had interrupted the Kurbana to hiss, "Stop digging! There's no gold in there." Her cousin wrote that in her new home, she slept and played with the other girls in the joint family, and that she was pleased to have nothing to do with her annoying husband. Her mother, reading the letter, had said knowingly, "Well, one day all that will change." The bride wonders if it now has, and what that means. There's a disturbance in the air. Her mother pushes her forward, then steps away. The groom looms beside her. And at once, the Achan begins the service. Does he have a cow ready to calve back in the barn? She gazes straight ahead. In the smudged lenses of the Achan's spectacles, she glimpses a reflection. A large figure silhouetted by the light from the entrance, and a tiny figure at his side, herself. What must it feel like to be 40 years old? He's older than her mother. A thought occurs to her. If he's widowed, why didn't he marry her mother instead of her? But she knows why. A widow's lot is only a little better than a leper's. Suddenly, the Achan's chant falters, because her future husband has pivoted to study her, his back turned unthinkably to the priest. He peers into her face, breathing like a man who has walked rapidly for a great distance. She dares not look up, but she catches his earthy scent. She can't control her trembling. She shuts her eyes.
"But this is just a child," she hears him exclaim.
When she opens her eyes, she sees her great uncle put out a hand to stop the departing groom, only to have it flicked away like an ant off a sleeping mat. Thangama runs out after the runaway groom, her apron of belly fat swinging side to side, despite the pressure of her hands. She overtakes him near a burden stone, a horizontal slab of rock at shoulder height, held up by two vertical stone pillars sunk into the ground, a place for a traveler to set down a headload and catch their breath. Thangama presses her hands on her brother's considerable chest, trying to slow him down as she walks backward before him.
Money, she says, because he's much younger, more like her son than her brother. Money, she pants.
What has transpired is serious, but it is comical how her brother pushes her as if he were a ploughman and she the plough, and she can't help but laugh. Look at me, she commands, still grinning. How often has she seen that frowning expression on his face, even as a baby? He was just 4 when their mother passed away and Thangama took over her role. Singing to him and holding him helped unfurrow his forehead. Much later, when their eldest brother cheated him of the house and property that should have been his, only Thangama stood up for him. He slows down. She knows him well, this hoarder of words. If God miraculously unlocked his jaw, what might he say?
Chechi, when I stood next to that shivering waif, I thought, this is who I'm supposed to marry? Did you see her chin trembling? I have my own child still at home to worry about. I hardly need another.
Mone, I understand, she says, as if he had spoken. I know how it looks. But don't forget your mother and your grandmother married when they were just 9. Yes, they were children. And they kept being raised as children in another household until they were no longer children. Does this not produce the most compatible and best of marriages? But forget all that. And just for a moment, think about that poor girl, stranded before the altar on her wedding day. Ayo, what shame. Who'll marry her after that? He keeps walking.
She's a good girl, Thangama says. Such a good family. Your little Jojo needs someone to look after him. She will be to him as I was to you when you were little.
Let her grow up in your household. She needs Parambil as much as Parambil needs her. She stumbles. He catches her, and she laughs.
Even elephants struggle to walk backwards.
Only she would construe the faint asymmetry on his face as a smile.
I picked this girl for you, Mone. Don't give that broker too much credit. I met the mother, and I saw the girl, even if she didn't know I saw her.
Didn't I choose well the first time? Your blessed first wife, God rest her soul, approves. So now, trust your Chechi once more. The marriage broker confers with the Achan, who mutters, what kind of business is this? The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. Her father taught the young bride to say that when she was scared. My rock and my fortress. A mysterious energy emanating from the altar now settles on her like a surplus, bringing a profound peace. This church is consecrated by one of the 12. He stood on the ground where she stands, the one apostle who touched Christ's wounds. She feels an understanding beyond imagination, a voice that speaks without sound or motion. It says, I am with you always. Then the groom's bare feet reappear beside her. How beautiful are the feet of the messengers who preach the gospel of peace. But these are brutish feet, calloused and impervious to thorns, capable of kicking down a rotting stump and adept at finding crevices to clamber up a palm tree. His feet shift, knowing they are being judged. She can't help herself. She peeks up at him. His nose is as sharp as an axe, the lips full, and the chin thrust out. His hair is jet black, with no gray, which surprises her. He's much darker than she is, but handsome. She's astonished by the intensity of his gaze as he stares at the priest. It's that of a mongoose awaiting the snake's strike so he can dodge, pivot, and seize it by the neck. The service must have gone by faster than she realized, because already her mother is helping the groom uncover her head. He moves behind her. He rests his hands on her shoulders as he ties the tiny gold minnu around her neck. His fingers brushing her skin feel as hot as coals. The groom makes his crude mark in the church register, then passes the pen to her. She enters her name and the day, month, and year, 1900. When she looks up, he's walking out of the church. The priest watches his receding form and says, "What? Did he leave the rice on the fire?" Her husband is not at the jetty, where a boat bobs and strains impatiently against its mooring. "From the time your husband was a little boy," says her new sister-in-law, "he's preferred his feet to carry him. Not me. Why walk when I can float?" Thangama's laughter coaxes them to join in. But now, at the water's edge, mother and daughter must part. They cling to each other. Who knows when they will see each other again? She has a new house name, a new home unseen, to which she now belongs. She must renounce the old one. Thangama's eyes are also moist. "You don't worry," she says to the distraught mother. "I'll care for her as if she were my own. I'm going to stay at Parambil 2 or 3 weeks. By then, she'll know our household better than her sams. Don't thank me. My children are all grown. I'll stay long enough for my husband to miss me." The young bride's legs wobble when she peels away from her mother. She might fall if not for Thangama swinging her onto one hip like a baby, then stepping into the waiting boat. She instinctively wraps her legs around Thangama's sturdy waist and presses her cheek to that meaty shoulder. From that perch, she gazes back at the forlorn figure waving from the jetty, a figure dwarfed by the giant stone crucifix rising behind her. The home of the young bride and her widower groom lies in Travancore, at the southern tip of India, sandwiched between the Arabian Sea and the Western Ghats, that long mountain range that runs parallel to the western coast. The land is shaped by water and its people united by a common language, Malayalam. Where the sea meets white beach, it thrusts fingers inland to intertwine with the rivers, snaking down the green canopied slopes of the Ghats. It is a child's fantasy world of rivulets and canals, a latticework of lakes and lagoons, a maze of backwaters and bottle-green lotus ponds, a vast circulatory system because, as her father used to say, all water is connected. It spawned a people, Malayalis, as mobile as the liquid medium around them, their gestures fluid, their hair flowing, ready to pour out laughter as they float from this relative's house to that one's, pulsing and roaming like blood corpuscles in a vasculature propelled by the great beating heart of the monsoon. In this land, coconut and palmyra palms are so abundant that at night their frilled silhouettes still sway and shimmer on the interior of closed eyelids. Dreams that augur well must have green fronds and water. Their absence defines a nightmare. When Malayalis say land, they include water, because it makes no more sense to separate the two than it does to detach the nose from the mouth. On skiffs, canoes, barges, and ferries, Malayalis and their goods flow all over Travancore, Cochin, and Malabar with a swiftness the landlocked cannot imagine. In the absence of decent roads and regular bus transport and bridges, water is the highway. In our young bride's time, the royal families of Travancore and Cochin, whose dynasties extend back to the Middle Ages, are under British rule as princely states. There are over 500 princely states under the British yoke, half of India's landmass, most of them minor and inconsequential. The Maharajas of the larger princely states, or salute states, Hyderabad, Mysore, and Travancore, are entitled to anywhere from a 9 to a 21-gun salute, the number reflecting a Maharaja's importance in the eyes of the British, and often equaling the count of Rolls-Royces in the royal's garage. In exchange for keeping palaces, cars, and status, and for being allowed to govern semi-autonomously, the Maharajas pay a tithe to the British out of the taxes they collect from their subjects. Our bride in her village in the princely state of Travancore has never seen a British soldier or civil servant. A situation quite unlike that in the presidencies of Madras or Bombay, territories administered directly by the British and teeming with them. In time, the Malayalam-speaking regions of Travancore, Cochin, and Malabar will come together to form the state of Kerala, a fish-shaped coastal territory at India's tip, its head pointing to Ceylon, now Sri Lanka, and its tail to Goa, while the eyes gaze wistfully across the ocean to Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Kuwait, and Riyadh. Push a spade into the soil anywhere in Kerala, and rust-tinged water wells up like blood under a scalpel, a rich laterite elixir that nourishes any living thing. One can dismiss the claims that aborted but viable fetuses cast away in that soil grow into feral humans. But there's no arguing that spices flourish here with an abundance unmatched anywhere else in the world. For centuries before Christ, sailors from the Middle East caught the southwesterlies in the lateen sails of their dhows to land on the Spice Coast and buy pepper, clove, and cinnamon. When the trade winds reversed, they returned to Palestine, selling the spices to buyers from Genoa and Venice for small fortunes. The spice craze swept over Europe like syphilis or the plague, and by the same means, sailors and ships. But this infection was salutary. Spices extended the life of food and whoever consumed it. There were other benefits. In Birmingham, a priest who chewed cinnamon to mask his wine breath found himself irresistible to female parishioners and pseudonymously penned the popular pamphlet, New Sauces Sweet and Sharp, a merry gallimaufry of couplings uncouth and pleasant for man and his wife. Apothecaries celebrated the miraculous cure of dropsy, gout, and lumbago by potions of turmeric, kokum, and pepper. A Marseille physician discovered that rubbing ginger on a small, flaccid penis reversed both states, and for the partner procured such pleasure that she objects to him getting off her again. Strangely, it never occurred to Western cooks to dry roast and grind together peppercorn, fennel seed, cardamom, cloves, and cinnamon, then throw that spice mix into oil along with mustard seed, garlic, and onions to make a masala, the foundation of any curry. Naturally, when spices fetched the price of precious jewels in Europe, the Arab sailors who brought them from India kept their source a secret for centuries. By the 1400s, the Portuguese, and later the Dutch, the French, and the English, made expeditions to find the land where these priceless spices grew. These seekers were like randy youths who'd caught the scent of a loose woman. Where was she? East. Always somewhere east. But Vasco da Gama went west from Portugal, not east. He sailed along the West African coast, rounded the Horn of Africa, and came back up the other side. Somewhere in the Indian Ocean, da Gama captured and tortured an Arab pilot who led him to the Spice Coast, present-day Kerala, landing near the city of Calicut. His was the longest ocean voyage yet undertaken. The Zamorin of Calicut was quite unimpressed by da Gama, and by his monarch who sent sea corals and brass as tributes when the Zamorin's presents were rubies, emeralds, and silk. He found it laughable that da Gama's stated ambition was to bring Christ's love to the heathens. Did the idiot not know that 1400 years before his arrival in India, even before St. Peter got to Rome, another of the 12 disciples, St. Thomas, had landed just down the coast on an Arab trading dhow? Legend has it that St. Thomas arrived in 52 AD, disembarking close to present-day Cochin.
he met a boy returning from the temple. "Does your God hear your prayers?" he asked. The boy said his God surely did. St. Thomas tossed water into the air, and the droplets remained suspended.
"Can your God do that?"
By such displays, whether magic or miracles, he converted a few Brahmin families to Christianity. Later, he was martyred in Madras. Those first converts, St. Thomas Christians, stayed true to the faith and did not marry outside their community. Over time, they grew, knitted together by their customs and their churches. Almost 2,000 years later, two descendants of those first Indian converts, a 12-year-old bride and a middle-aged widower, have married.
"Happened has happened," our young bride will say when she becomes a grandmother, and when her granddaughter, her namesake, begs for a story about their ancestors. The little girl has heard rumors that theirs is a genealogy chock full of secrets, and that her ancestors include slavers, murderers, and a defrocked bishop.
"Child, the past is past, and furthermore, it's different every time I remember it. I'll tell you about the future, the one you will make."
But the child insists.
Where should the story begin?
With doubting Thomas, who insisted on seeing Christ's wounds before he'd believe?
With other martyrs to the faith?
What the child clamors for is the story of their own family, of the widower's house into which her grandmother married, a landlocked dwelling in a land of water, a house full of mysteries. But such memories are woven from gossamer threads. Time eats holes in the fabric, and these she must darn with myth and fable. The grandmother is certain of a few things. A tale that leaves its imprint on a listener tells the truth about how the world lives. And so, unavoidably, it is about families, their victories and wounds, and their departed, including the ghosts who linger. It must offer instructions for living in God's realm, where joy never spares one from sorrow. A good story goes beyond what a forgiving God cares to do. It reconciles families and unburdens them of secrets whose bond is stronger than blood. But in their revealing, as in their keeping, secrets can tear a family apart.
Chapter 3. Things Not Mentioned. 1900, Parambil. The new bride dreams that she's splashing in the lagoon with her cousins, piling onto their narrow skiff, deliberately capsizing it, and clambering on again, their laughter echoing off the banks. She awakes confused. A snoring mound beside her swells and subsides. Thangama, yes. Her first night at Parambil. That name rubs awkwardly over her tongue like the edge of a chipped tooth. From next door, her husband's room, she hears nothing. Thangama's body hides a small boy. She sees only the shiny, tousled hair on his head and a hand, palm up, resting just beyond it. She listens. Something is missing. The absence is disquieting. It comes to her. She cannot hear water. She's missing its murmuring, soothing voice, and so she manufactured it in her dream. Yesterday, the wallam, a dugout buttressed across with planks, dropped her and Thangama at a small jetty. They crossed a long field dotted with towering coconut palms laden with fruit. Four cows grazed, each tethered on a long rope. They walked through rows of banana trees, the floppy leaves nuzzling and knocking against each other. Bunches of red bananas hung down. The air was perfumed by a champaka tree. Three well-worn polished rocks served as stepping stones across a shallow stream. Further up, the stream broadened into a pond whose banks were overgrown with pandanus shrubs and dwarf chindangu palms
laden with orange-colored coconuts. An inclined washing stone sat near the pond's edge. Thangama said that spot was where she should come to bathe. The stream's burble was a sound that augured well. She'd looked for the house when they landed at the jetty, but it wasn't there by the river, so surely it must be by the stream. But she saw nothing.
"All this land, over 500 acres, Thangama said proudly, pointing left and right, "is Paramil. Most of it is wild, hilly, not cleared. Of the part that is rough cleared, only a portion is cultivated. Before your husband tamed it, this was all jungle, Mole."
500 acres. The home she'd known till yesterday sat on barely 2. They'd continued through a trail flanked by tapioca. At last she saw the house, high up on a rise, silhouetted against the light. She stared at what would be her home for the rest of her life. The roofline had the familiar sag in the middle, curving up to the ends. The low, overhanging eaves blocked the sun and shaded the veranda. But all she could think about was, why up there? Why not by the stream? Or by the river that brings visitors, news, and all good things? Now, lying on her back, she studies the room. The oiled, polished walls are of teak, not wild jackwood, with crucifix-shaped openings at the top through which warm air can escape. The false ceiling is also of teak, a buffer against the heat. Thin wooden bars across the windows allow the breeze to pass freely, and of course, there's a split door leading out to the veranda, the upper half now open to admit the breeze, the lower half closed to keep out chickens as well as all legless creatures. It's much like the house she left behind, only bigger. Every thuchan or carpenter follows the same ancient vastu rules, from which neither Hindu nor Christian will deviate. For a good thuchan, the house is the bridegroom and the land is the bride, and he must match the two with as much care as the astrologer matches horoscopes. When tragedy or a haunting hangs over a household, people would say it's because the dwelling was inauspiciously sited. And so she asked herself again, why here, away from water? A rustle of leaves, a tremble transmitted through the ground, sends her heart racing. Something near the door blocks the starlight. Is this a household ghost coming to introduce itself? Next, a leafy bush seems to grow into the room through the upper half of the door. A huge snake coils around the bush. She can neither move nor scream, even though she knows something terrible is about to happen to her in this mysterious landlocked house. But would death smell like jasmine? A swatch of uprooted jasmine hovers above her, held fast by the trunk of an elephant. The florets sway over the sleepers, then pause over her. She feels a warm, moist, ancient breath on her face. Fine soil particles fall on her neck. Her fear subsides. Hesitantly, she reaches for the offering. She's surprised that the nostrils look so human. Fringed by paler, freckled skin, as delicate as a lip, yet as nimble and dexterous as 2 fingers. It snuffles at her chest, tickles her elbow, then traces a path to her face. She suppresses a giggle. Hot exhalations puff down on her, like benedictions. The scent is something out of the Old Testament. Noiselessly, the trunk withdraws. She turns to find she has a startled witness. 2-year-old Jojo sits staring over Thangama's midriff, his eyes wide. She grins, rising, impulsively beckoning him and lifting him to her hip, and they head outside, following the apparition. She senses spirits everywhere in Parambal, just as in any house. One paces outside on the mitam. The darkness flickers with invisible souls as plentiful as fireflies. in a clearing by a towering palm, hovering over a stack of coconut fronds, the retinal glow of an eye sways like a lamp in a breeze. As her vision adjusts, a mountain of a forehead emerges, then languidly flapping ears, a sculpture carved from the black stone of night. The elephant is real, not a ghost. Jojo absent-mindedly encircles her neck with one arm, his fingers clutching her earlobe, comfortably settled on her hip, as if he's never known any other. She wants to laugh. Just yesterday, she was the one clinging to Thangama. They stand still, two half-orphans. The spirits take their orders from the jasmine giver and retreat into the shadows that yield to the dawn. In her short life, she's seen temple elephants worshipped and pampered with treats. She's seen logging elephants lumbering through villages on their way to the forest. But surely this beast, blocking out the stars, is the world's biggest elephant. To watch its leisurely chew, the graceful dance of the trunk as it folds leaves into a grinning mouth, soothes her. On the elephant's leeward side, just beyond the mud bund that creates a moat around every coconut tree to keep water and manure from draining away, a man sleeps on a rope cot. Her husband's elbows and knees jut from the sagging wooden frame. In the posture of his powerful left arm, curled to make a pillow for his cheek, the fingers gathered to a point, she sees echoes of her jasmine-bearing visitor. Chapter 4. A Householder's Initiation. 1900, Parambil. Inside the kitchen, the packed earth floor feels cool on her soles. The walls are dark from smoke, and they enfold mouth-watering scents. She is immediately at home in this shady sanctuary. Thangama, bent over, blows through a wide metal tube, her cheeks ballooning as she coaxes the overnight embers in the adapu back to life. Of the 6 brick slots in this raised hearth, pots are sitting on 4. She marvels at how fast Thangama moves for a big woman, her hands a blur, feeding dry coconut husks under the pan with the frying onions here and flattening embers there so the rice can now simmer. Thangama pours the bride coffee brewed in milk and sweetened with jaggery. "I made puttu," she says, pushing a spongy white cylinder of steamed rice flour out of its wooden mold and onto her banana leaf plate. For Jojo, she mashes it with banana and honey. She's warmed up the beef fry, erichi olorthiyada, and the fiery fish curry, mean vevichida, from the previous night. "Isn't the fish tastier in the morning? That's the beauty of this clay pot. Treasure it and never use it for anything but mean vevichida, all right? Every year, your curry will get better. If there's a fire in my house, and I must choose between my husband and my clay pot, well, all I can say is, he's lived a good life. The curries I will make in my pot will ease my widowhood." Thangama's laughter rings out. The bride sits dazed, cross-legged, contemplating her first breakfast at Parambil. It is lavish and more nourishing than what she and her mother ate in a week. "Your husband ate standing as usual. He's already gone to the field." Thangama insists that a bride should do nothing but let herself be spoiled. She tries, but it's against her nature. She watches Thangama's fingers, trying to keep track of the ingredients they toss into the curries, but it's hard when there are never fewer than 2 dishes being made at the same time. Thangama's hands must have a memory of their own, she thinks, because their owner pays no attention to them as she chatters away. Jojo drags her away, proud to be her guide, walking her through every room, forgetting he just did it 2 hours before. The house is L-shaped, one limb being the older, original house, sitting well off the ground on a high plinth, and constructed around the strong room, or ara,
in which a family's wealth, money, jewelry, and paddy are stored. A cellar sits below the ara, while an unused bedroom and a large pantry flank it. Next to the pantry is the kitchen. A narrow outer veranda connects everything. The newer limb of the house is lower to the ground, with a broad, inviting veranda on three sides. It has a sitting room that gets little use, then two adjacent large bedrooms, her husband's and the one she, Jojo, and Thangama sleep in, and another room that is used as a storeroom. Old and new limbs embrace a rectangular mitam, or courtyard, surfaced with yellow, gold, and white pebbles hauled from a river bed. Each morning, a Pulayi woman, Sara, sweeps the mitam with a stick broom, leaving a fan-shaped pattern as she clears away dead leaves while evening out the pebbles. The mitam is where mats are rolled out to dry boiled paddy, where clothes hang on a line, and where Jojo kicks his ball. After lunch, she, Jojo, and Thangama take long naps. Her husband never naps, and spends most of his time outdoors working the land. When she catches a glimpse of him in the fields, he's always accompanied by a few pulayar standing out from them because of his height and because, compared to theirs, his skin looks fair. In the evenings, Thangama puts her feet up and the three of them sit in the breezeway outside the kitchen as the older woman tells endless stories while spoiling Jojo and her with treats from the cellar. Belatedly, it occurs to her that Thangama's stories are a form of instruction. She tries to recall them at night when she lies down to sleep, but that's also when homesickness clutches at her insides and her every thought turns homeward. Thangama's affection is so reminiscent of her mother that it can accentuate her sadness. She allows herself to cry only when she's certain everyone is asleep. On her second morning, when they hear the fishmonger's yodeling cry in the distance, Thangama asks the bride to hail her. 5 minutes later, the woman is outside the kitchen, the scent of the river clinging to her. Thangama helps her lower the heavy basket off her head. "Ah, and this is the bride," the fishmonger says, brushing scales off her forearms and squatting down. "For her only I brought special mathi today." She removes the sackcloth covering the basket as though uncovering precious jewels. Thangama sniffs a sardine, squeezes it, and then slaps it down against its mates. "Just for the bride, is it? Ah, keep it if it's that special. What's under that cloth? Ah, see that? Who's that mati for? Was there another marriage I didn't know about? Give it here." "Not a word." The next day, the bride sees Samuel Pulayan crossing the mitam, straining under a head load of coconuts in a wide basket. Thangama had pointed him out as Parambal's foreman and her husband's constant shadow. Sara, who sweeps the mitam, is his wife. "Samuel's family has worked for them for generations," Thangama said. "His forebears were probably indentured to the family in ancient times before that was outlawed. The Pulayar are the lowest caste in Travancore, rarely owning their own property, even their huts belonging to the landlord. The sight of them is enough to pollute a Brahmin, who then must take a ritual bath." Under the weight of his basket, Samuel's neck and arm muscles are taut cables on his small, compact frame. His bare chest heaves. His ribs appear to be more out of the skin than in. His body is quite hairless, save for stubble on his cheek and above his lip, and a cropped head of hair graying at the sides. He looks her husband's age, though Thangama said he's younger. When Samuel spots her, a huge smile transforms his face, his cheekbones shining like polished mounds of ebony, and the white, even teeth highlighting his fine features. There's a childlike quality to his excitement at getting to welcome the new bride. "Ah," he says, but there's a practical matter to deal with first.
Mole, could you ask Thangama Cheshi to come out? This basket might be too heavy for you to help me.
Once Thangama helps him lower the basket, he removes the tortu coiled atop his head, shakes it out, then wipes his face, neither his smile nor his eyes leaving the new bride.
More baskets coming. We've been climbing all morning, the Thambran and me.
He points, and she sees her husband in the distance, arms crossed, sitting astride a crooked palm at a spot where the trunk is almost horizontal. His legs dangle carelessly, and he looks lost in thought. The sight makes her shudder involuntarily, stirring up her fear of heights. She can't imagine a landowner risking his life like that when there are pulayar to do that work.
How come you let the Thambran up there so soon after his wedding?
Thangama says, acting cross.
Tell the truth, if he climbs, it's half the work for you.
Ah, you try to stop him. He's like the little Thambran here, he says, prodding Jojo's belly. Happier in the sky than on the ground.
Jojo is pleased to be called the little master. Shamuel's bare chest is flecked with bark. Still grinning at the Thambran's wife, he fastidiously pleats his blue-checked tortu lengthwise and then drapes it over his left shoulder. She turns shy and drops her eyes, noticing his deformed right big toe, flattened out like a coin, the nail gone.
Thangama says, Ah, Shamuel, please husk 3 coconuts for us then. After that, wash up and come eat something. Your new mistress will serve you.
Shamuel has his own clay dish hanging from a hook under the overhang of the roof at the back of the kitchen, and that's where he will eat, on the back steps. Pulayar never enter the house. Sara cooks for him at home, but a meal at the main house spares his store of paddy. After rinsing out his dish, he fills it with water and drinks it all, and then squats on the step. The bride serves him kanyi, soupy rice in its cooking water, with a piece of fish and lime pickle.
You like it here, then? He asks,
a big ball of rice bulging his cheek. She stands shyly before him and nods. Her finger absent-mindedly traces the first letter in Ana, or elephant, a letter she thinks somehow manages to resemble an elephant.
I was younger than you when I came to Parambil. Just a boy, you know, he says. Before there was even a house. I feared we'd be trampled as we slept. A house protects you. The secret is the roof, did you know? Why do you think we always build it this way?
To her eyes, the roof is like any other. Only the front gable, the face of the house with its pattern of carved openings in the wood, is unique to every home. Everywhere else, the thatch eaves flare out as though the roof intends to swallow the dwelling. Shamuel points.
When the rafters stick out like that, an elephant has no flat surface on which to lean or push.
He's like Jojo in his pride in instructing her. She takes to him. The elephant came to greet me on my first night, she offers in a small voice.
Did he? Damodran?
Shamuel says, laughing, shaking his head.
That fellow comes and goes as he pleases. I was about to sleep, but I felt the ground shake. I knew it was him. I went out, and there was Unni sitting atop of him, grumbling because Damo chose to come from the logging camp when it was already dark. Ah! But Unni didn't complain too much. Whenever Damo is here, Unni gets the nights off to be home with his wife, and the Thambran sleeps next to Damo. They talk.
Keeping an elephant, she has heard, is expensive. Not just paying for Unni, who must be the mahout, but the cost of feeding Damo.
Is Damodran ours?
Ours? Is the son ours?
Shamuel waits like a schoolmaster for her to shake her head to say no.
Ah, just like the son? Damodran is his own boss. I tease Unni that Damo is really the mahout, even if he lets Unni sit on top and pretend to steer him.
No one told you about Damo?
Ah, let Shamuel tell you.
Long before there was this house, as the Thambran and my father slept outside, they heard terrible cries, trumpeting. The ground shook. The sound of trees cracking was like thunder. My father thought the world was ending. At dawn, they found young Damodaran just over there on his side, one eye gone, bleeding, with a broken tusk sticking out between his ribs. The bull elephant that attacked him must have been in must. The Thambran tied a rope around that tusk and then, standing far away, he pulled it out. You've seen the tusk. It's in Thambran's room. Damodaran bellowed in pain. Bubbles and blood poured out of the wound. Thambran, so brave he is, climbed up onto Damo's side and plugged the hole with leaves and mud. He poured water little by little into Damodaran's mouth and sat there talking to him all that day and night. He said more to Damo than he has to all the people in his life put together. That's what my father said. After 3 days, Damodaran got up. A week later, he walked away. A few days after that, the Thambran and my father cut a big teak tree and were trying to lever it to the clearing. Damodaran stepped out from the forest and pushed it for them, just like that. Elephants like to work. He became so good with logs. Now he works in the teak forests with the loggers, but only when he feels like it. Whenever he decides, he comes back here. He came to see the Thambran's new wife. Ah, that's what I think.
Under Thangama's guidance, she slowly eases into her new life at Parambal. With every passing day, she feels the home she left behind fade, which makes her longing more acute. She doesn't want to forget. After breakfast, Thangama says, "Today I thought we can make jackfruit halwa together, because Jojo and I are craving it." Jojo claps his hands. "Mole, the sweetness of life is sure in only two things, love and sugar. If you don't get enough of the first, have more of the second." Thangama has already boiled pieces of jackfruit, and now she mashes them with melted jaggery. "Here's a secret. As you mash the jackfruit, close your eyes and think of something you want from your husband." Thangama screws her eyes shut, grinning from the effort and showing off the gap between her front teeth. "Now a pinch of cardamom, salt, and a teaspoon of ghee. Ready. It must cool more now. Taste it. Isn't it wonderful?" She lowers her voice. "I'm serious, Bole. This is the key to a happy marriage. Make your wish and then feed your husband this halwa. Whatever you want will come true." Her pride in getting into the rhythm of the household, of making a few dishes under Thangama's watchful eye, is undercut by the knowledge that Thangama must soon leave. When Thangama lavishly praises her chicken curry, she glows with pride, but in the next moment she finds herself clinging to Thangama, burying her face on that well-padded shoulder to hide her tears. "Please stay, never leave." But already she loves Thangama too much to say it. Thangama has her own house to run, a husband who awaits her. She mumbles, "I will never forget your kindness. How can I ever thank you?"
"Ah, when you have a daughter-in-law, treat her like a jewel. That's how you can thank me."
The day before she is to leave, Thangama steps out of the kitchen and peers up at the sun, finding it directly overhead.
"Mole, cut a banana leaf and pack a lunch for your husband. Let him taste your bean thoran and also the mati we fried. Put plenty of rice. He's out there somewhere with Shamuel, no doubt, always surveying his land. See that tall coconut palm? He'll be somewhere there."
The bride obediently ladles the food onto a banana leaf, folds it and secures it with string. She picks up a small brass vessel with jeera water, water boiled with cumin seeds, and heads out. She's anxious about Thangama's imminent departure
That morning she discovered that no paper or pen existed at Parambal. Her hopes of writing down some of Thangama's recipes are dashed. What if she forgets them? The footpath is lined by tall grass that reaches her shoulder. Thangama had said it was once so overgrown that neither God nor light could penetrate, and the undergrowth was alive with scorpions, cobras, giant rats, and biting centipedes. "What Hindu or Christian would be mad enough to try to settle here?" Thangama had said. "Your husband came here after our oldest brother tricked him out of the family home by getting him to make a mark on a piece of paper." Samuel's father, Yohanan Pulayan, came along, seeing it as his duty to serve the rightful heir. Later, Yohanan brought his wife and son. The two men built a rough shelter.
"Can you imagine my brother sleeping under the same roof as his Pulayar? Eating with them? All barriers of caste vanish when you enter hell, is it not? Only the saints kept them alive. The first week, a tiger carried off their only goat. They had more days with fever than without, but they dug, drained the marsh, never stopped clearing. Mole, I tell you this, not just because I'm proud of my little brother, but so that you know his ways are not the ways of everyone. Yohanan was like a father to him, and like that only, his son Samuel will be there for you and your family for a lifetime."
Thangama said her husband enticed a skilled Hindu tachan and a blacksmith to move to the area by offering them cleared plots by the stream and ensuring that the Pulayar huts would be downstream so these craftsmen couldn't complain of ritual pollution. The potter, goldsmith, and stonemason came later. After his house was built, her husband gave 1 to 2 acre plots to a number of his relatives. Once they cultivated their land and sold their harvest, these relatives could buy more land from him if they wanted.
"You understand what I'm telling you, Mole? He gave the land outright. They can pass it to their children. He wanted this area to prosper. He's not done. Who knows? Next time I come to visit, there might be a proper road, provision stores, a school."
"A church?" she'd suggested. But to that, Thangama made no answer. She finds her husband gazing up at a tree, his bare chest flecked with bark, a fierce vritukathi hanging from his waist, the billhook pointing back. He's surprised to see her. He takes the food.
"That, Thangama."
The smile is in his voice, not his face. He sits resting against the tree, but not before spreading his tortu for her to sit on. He wolfs down the food. She doesn't say a word. She's astonished to realize that her shyness is matched by his. When he's finished, he rises and says, "I'll walk back with you." She hears shouts and laughter. On their left, in the distance, a log straddles a rivulet she hasn't seen before. On the other bank in a clearing sits a large burden stone. These crude structures stand like primitive monuments along well-traveled footpaths, allowing a traveler to ease their heavy head load onto the horizontal slab and rest for a while. She sees a young man push and rock the horizontal beam of the burden stone while two friends egg him on. All three have streaks of sandalwood paste on their foreheads. The one doing the pushing is powerfully built, his head shaved except for a knotted tuft in the front. The horizontal slab comes off its supports and hits the ground, raising a cloud of red dust. The miscreant's face is flushed with pride and excitement. She pictures Samuel returning from the mill, balancing a heavy sack of ground rice flour on his head, anticipating the burden stone where he can bend his knees just enough to slide the sack onto the horizontal slab. He would be forced to go on, or else to drop the sack and wait until someone came by to help lift it back onto his head.
in a land where most everything is transported in this manner, where roads are regularly washed away or too rotted for bullock carts, and where only the footpaths are reliable, a rest station like this is a blessing. The young men spot the couple and turn silent. They look well-fed, the sort who never have to carry a load or require a burdenstone. By their dress and appearance, she thinks they are Nairs. A large Nair family lives along the western edge of Parambal. The Nairs are a warrior caste, employed by generations of Travancore Maharajas to defend against invaders. Her father's Nair friend had looked the part, sporting a fierce moustache to go with his strong physique. Under British rule, the Maharaja had their protection and no longer needed his Nair army. Govind Nair had been bitter.
How can he call himself ruler of Travancore? He's a puppet who hands over our taxes to the British. The British protect him. From what? Isn't the enemy already inside the walls?
Her husband half hitches his mundu, exposing his knees as he marches to the log bridge, but reaching it, he crosses very gingerly. The youths snigger at this, but still, they brace themselves as this older bull elephant approaches. Her stomach churns. To her astonishment, her husband ignores them and squats down to the stone instead.
So, you're strong enough to push it over. Are you strong enough to put it back? Why don't you? The boy says cheekily, but with a quaver in his voice.
Her husband gets his fingers under one pole of the fallen beam, heaves it to waist height and walks it upright. Then he lets the stone beam tip back on the fulcrum of his shoulder where it seesaws. His quivering thighs are like tree trunks, and his neck muscles are thick ropes as he maneuvers one end and then the other back atop the vertical pillars. He leans on the restored slab to catch his breath. With a sudden thrust, he pushes it off its support again. It thuds to the ground and rolls to the youths, who must leap back. Flicking his eyebrows up, he challenges the tall youth. Your turn. An unnatural quiet hangs over the clearing, like water suspended in the air. At last, her husband calls out to her.
They're just dressed like men. This boy's father and I put up the stone before this one was born. Now, in his old age, Kutupanar must clean up behind his calf. But he lifts this stone as if it's a toothpick.
He turns his back to them and returns. The top knot falls forward as the young man bends and tries to lift the stone, grimacing, veins popping out like snakes on his forehead. When he gets it upright, his muscles fail him, and his friends rush forward to keep it from crushing him. When he tries to ease it onto his shoulder, it sways wildly. They restore the beam, but all three look ruffled and bruised, and the tall one's shoulder bleeds. Her husband sees none of this, arriving beside her, his face thick with anger, terrifying her. With a quick tilt of his head, he conveys his thanks for lunch and his need to get back to work. She runs home. Thangamma takes one look at her face and sits her down.
Those boys are lucky that he controlled his temper, Thangamma says after hearing what happened.
Her words are hardly reassuring, and the cup of water in the bride's hand shakes.
Molly, don't worry. He'll never be angry without cause, and never at you. He would never mistreat you.
Thangamma puts an arm around her. I know this is all new and frightening. When I got married, my husband and I were only 10. He was a naughty brat. We ignored each other. We were just children in a big house, and there were so many of us. The boys were all mean. One time, I saw him sitting on a log looking at the stream. I came up quietly and I pushed him into the water.
Her laugh is infectious and the bride cannot help but smile.
He likes to remind me of that day even now.
Yes, we disliked each other, but see, things don't stay the same. Don't you worry.
Thangamma looks at her and adds earnestly, What I'm trying to say is that my brother is like a coconut. The hardness is all on the outside. You're his wife, and he cares for you as Thangamma cares for you. You understand?
She tries to.
Thangamma, who's never at a loss for words, seems uncomfortable saying even this much.
There's nothing you have to do. Don't worry. It'll all unfold in its own time.
Chapter 5. Husbandry. 1900 Parambil. In the wake of Thangamma's departure, silence descends on the house, a feeling of being underwater with too little light filtering through. Jojo, unsettled, doesn't let his stepmother out of his sight. Even in sleep, his small fingers are curled in her hair. Their first night alone, she's awake not because of her husband's snores from the adjacent bedroom, but because she has never slept without an adult beside her. His snores, though distant, are reassuring. They are punctuated occasionally by a cough and then a disgruntled rasp as if someone prodded a slumbering tiger. He talks in his sleep, more words than he's said to her since her arrival. Seeing him be so playful with Damodaran, who has left as mysteriously as he came, she knows there's a childlike side to him. Still, she only dares speak to him to tell him dinner is ready. Samuel comes by several times during the day to ask if she needs anything and is disappointed if she doesn't. She's touched by his concern.
Samuel, there is something I need.
Ooh, anything.
Paper, envelope, and a pen to write to my mother.
The eager smile on his face fades.
Ah.
He clearly has no experience with those commodities. Still, he surprises her when he returns from the market, proudly retrieving envelopes, paper, and a pen from the collapsed sack on his head.
My dear Amachi, may this letter find you in good health. Thangamma was here all this time. I manage well. I cook several dishes.
Not long after her father died, her mother lost her dominion in the kitchen. She bemoaned the fact that she hadn't taught her daughter to cook before her wedding.
It's just me and Jojo now. He is my shadow. Without him, I think I would miss you so much more. The only trouble he gives me is when I want to bathe him.
When she first tried it, Jojo fought her. Still, she poured water over his head. But then he turned pale, his eyelids fluttering like a moth's wings and his eyeballs rolling in their sockets. She was terrified, thinking he was about to have a convulsion. She never poured water on his head again, resorting instead to a washcloth for his hair and face. Even so, it's a daily battle. There's a war, she now sees, between the men of Parambil and the waters of Travancore. She won't share this with her poor mother. Maybe she already knows.
How can I be a better householder, a better mistress of the house?
She wishes she could erase that sentence, because her mother is no longer the householder or the mistress of the house. Her trials in the joint family home began soon after she became a widow, her brothers and sister-in-law's characters changing. Her mother likely sleeps on the veranda now and is bullied and treated like a maid. Meanwhile, at Parambil, her daughter lacks for nothing. Grain threatens to spill out of the ara, and the lockbox is never short of coins.
When I pray in the evening, I say to myself, my Amachi is also praying right now. That way I feel close to you. I miss you so much. But I cry only at night when Jojo can't see me. I wish I had brought my Bible. There isn't one here. I know Parambil is far, but please, Amachi, come visit me. Come stay a few nights. My husband doesn't like to travel by boat. If you can't come, maybe I will try to come. I'll have to bring Jojo. She pictures her mother reading the letter, her mother's tears staining the page just as hers do. She imagines her folding the letter under her pillow, then keeping it with her few possessions in her bedroll. Then, in her thoughts, she sees a hand, her aunt's, probing in the bedroll while her mother bathes. It keeps her from asking her mother if she's eating better now that there's one less mouth to feed. A part of her wants those prying eyes to read those words and recognize the injustice in their souls. But it would only make things more difficult for her mother. A reply comes in 3 weeks through the Achan who performed the marriage and who travels to the diocese office in Kotem every 2 weeks. There he mails and collects letters, if there are any. A boy brings it over to the house. In her letter, her mother showers her with love and kisses and says she's proud to imagine her daughter stepping into the role of householder thanks to Thangama's coaching. At the end of the letter, her mother, uncharacteristically and strongly, dissuades her daughter from coming back to visit, giving no explanation. And she doesn't respond to her daughter's impassioned request that she please visit Parambil. The letter only makes her worry more about her mother's welfare. Thangama's homilies run wild in her head, like braids that have come unraveled. The bottom tier of a banana bunch always has an even number, and the tier above is odd. If someone tried to sneak off with just one, Thangama would know. To maintain the pattern, they would have to remove a banana from each row, and that would be obvious. But then again, who would steal? Be observant. That must have been Thangama's lesson. Yet that morning, she isn't. She ignores a speckled hen's urgent clucking and its repeated and determined forays into the kitchen, shooing it away.
She's ready to lay an egg, Amachi, Jojo says.
Did Jojo just call her Amachi? Little mother? Her chest swells with pride. She hugs him. What would I do without you, little man?
She grabs the hen and sets it on a sack in the pantry, then inverts a wicker basket over it. The hen fusses indignantly at her from the dark.
Forgive me. I'll be listening for you when you're done. I promise.
There are few visitors. She feels very alone. She daydreams of her mother strolling up from the jetty, surprising her with a visit. She conjures this up so often that she finds herself glancing in the direction of the river several times a day. The only visitors she's met properly are Georgie and Dolly from the tiny house closest to Parambil on the south side. It was Thangama they came to see, and they came just once. Georgie is the son of her husband's brother, the one who tricked him out of his birthright. Their house sits on a 2-acre plot that her husband gave to his nephew because, in the end, Georgie's father died destitute, leaving Georgie and his twin brother nothing but debt. She liked Dolly Kochema at once. Since Dolly's at least 5 years older, Kochema is how she addresses her. Dolly is fair, with doe eyes, a quiet woman who feels no pressure to speak, her expression one of saintly patience. Georgie is the lively, gregarious type, surprising the new bride by happily crowding into the cozy kitchen with the women, something her husband would never do. She wonders why her husband would generously rescue his nephew, yet have so little to do with him. Samuel says that Georgie isn't much of a farmer, not like the Thumbran. But if her husband is the standard, no one measures up. Perhaps Georgie feels unworthy of his uncle's gift. Jojo never lets his Amachi out of his sight, except when she goes to the stream to bathe,
or when she goes to the river near the jetty and plunges in, something she loves to do.
Jojo waits anxiously at home for her return. For Jojo, bath in any form remains a daily battle. She loves her bathing spot where the creek broadens, forming a pool, the water so slow and clear she sees tiny fish swimming in it, yet deep enough that her toes barely touch the bottom. The inclined washing stone squats on the bank beneath the shade of a rambutan tree whose hairy red fruits hang down like ornaments. Parambil is bursting with mangoes. Shamuel Pulayan and his helpers bring in basket after basket, forming a mountain in the foyer outside the kitchen. Even after dispatching full bags to the Pulayar huts, to the craftsmen, to their relatives, there are too many left. The sweet fleshy varietal that comes in hues of yellow, orange, and pink fills the kitchen with a fruity perfume. Jojo's chin is raw from the juice that drips. She pulps as much as she can for syrups and jams. With the remaining pulp, she makes thera, mango fruit jerky. First, she cooks it with sugar and roasted rice flour. She spreads this paste onto a woven mat as long and as wide as a door and places it in the sun. Jojo's task is to chase off birds and insects. After it dries, she adds more layers, waiting for each one to dry before spreading the next, until it is an inch thick and can be cut into strips. She's thrilled to see her husband carry away a plug of thera after breakfast and lunch, chewing on it as he works. As a treat for Jojo, she carves an unripe mango, splaying it open like a lotus flower, a trick her mother taught her, then sprinkling it with salt and red chili powder. Jojo finishes every last sour and spicy morsel and then walks around sucking air through pursed lips, his mouth on fire, but begging for more. The ara, the central windowless room of the old part of the house, is built like a fortress. Its one-piece door is three times as thick as a regular door, and it is protected by a huge lock for which she has the key. The sill is so high to contain the padian there that while her husband steps over it, she must climb over. Inside, her feet sink into the grain that reaches her knees. She opens the ara at least once a week to get money from the strongbox and less often to remove paddy or to store it. Beneath the ara and accessed by small stairs from the adjacent unused bedroom is a dark, musty cellar where she keeps her preserves in tall porcelain jars. Razor-thin shafts of light come through the ventilation grill cut into the wood. Every house has its indoor and outdoor ghosts, and those in the Parambil house are still new to her. She resolves to speak to the one who inhabits the cellar because she has reason to suspect that it has an awful sweet tooth. She feels it hiding in the corner behind the cobwebs, a gentle, sad, and perhaps frightened spirit, more wary of her than she of it. "Help yourself to anything you choose, I don't mind, but do put the lid back on tight," she says, standing bravely before it. She had planned to add, "Please don't try to bother me." But just then, Jojo's indignant voice rings out,
"Amachi, where are you? When you play hide-and-seek, you have to hide where I can see you, or it's not fair."
She can't help giggling. A sudden lightness in the closed air of the cellar tells her the ghost is laughing too. Only after she emerges does she wonder if this spirit might be Jojo's deceased mother. When the monsoon arrives and the clouds open, she's ecstatic. In her father's house, she and her cousin would oil their hair and step out into the downpour with their soap and coconut fiber scrub, delighting in the heavenly waterfall. They anticipated the monsoon as much as they did Christmas, a time when body and soul are cleansed
The dust and the shed skin of insects cemented to stalks are swept away, leaving a brilliant shine on leaves. Without the monsoon, this land whose flag is green and whose coin is water would cease to exist. When people grumble about flooding, about flare-ups of gout and rheumatism, they do so with a smile. The rain never holds anyone back. Her umbrella becomes a halo that goes wherever she goes outdoors, while her bare feet happily slosh through puddles. Samuel fashions a cap from palmyra bark that allows water to sheet off his head. But Rain confines her husband in a way that baffles her. She's not brave enough to probe. She gradually gets accustomed to seeing him sitting for hours and sometimes all day on the veranda, like a child forbidden from play, subdued, glowering at the clouds as though that might persuade them to reverse their course. He has Jojo for company because Jojo is the same way. Once, an unexpected rain squall caught her husband unawares, without an umbrella, as he approached the house. The raindrops seemed to make him stagger, his legs turning wobbly as he ran for shelter, as if stones and not water had fallen on his head. Another evening, she sees him seated near the well, bathing by soaping and rinsing his body in sections. He doesn't see or hear her. She's tempted to run away, but is too mesmerized by this sight of his body to move. She roils with emotions. Guilt for spying on him? A terrible urge to giggle? Embarrassment, as if she were the one naked. And a fascination with this sight of her husband fully revealed. He has never looked more powerful and frightening, even if this piecemeal bathing renders him childlike. There's a practiced ease and elegance to his miserliness with water, but the element missing from his movements is pleasure. Every morning when she reawakens the embers in the hearth, the kitchen welcomes her like a sister with no secrets, and it makes her happy. She's come to believe this has everything to do with the benevolent presence of Jojo's mother. The cellar may be the spirit's preferred haunt and the place where what is amorphous comes as close as it can to taking physical form, but her spirit also drifts up here, drawn by the crackle of the hearth fire or the voice of her child conversing with his new amici. Why else do the bride's dishes turn out better than she has any right to expect? Since Thangama's recipes are hopelessly muddled in her head, she cannot give all the credit to the seasoned clay pots. No, she's being rewarded for taking loving care of Jojo. She feels one with the rhythm of the house and has the sense she is running it well.
Chapter 6. Couples. 1903. Parambal. In the 3 years since her arrival, she's transformed the covered breezeway outside the kitchen into her personal space. She has a rope cot here where she and Jojo nap after lunch and where she teaches the 5-year-old his letters. It allows her to keep an eye on the pots on the hearth and the paddy drying on mats in the mitten. While Jojo sleeps, she sits on the cot rereading the only printed material in the house, an old issue of the Manorama. She can't bring herself to throw the paper away. If she does, there'll be nothing, no words on which her eyes might rest. She's tired of chastising herself for not bringing a Bible with her to Parambal. Instead, she directs her annoyance to Jojo's mother. It's unthinkable for a Christian household not to have the holy book. Jojo stirs just as she sees Samuel returning from the market with the shopping, a sack balanced on his head. He squats before her and empties the sack before folding it away. Samuel mops his face with his thwartu, his eyes falling on the newspaper.
"What does it say?"
he asks, pointing with his chin, as he smooths out his torso and drapes it over his shoulder.
Do you think something new crawled in there since the last time I read it to you, Samuel?
Ah, he says. His graying brows frame eyes that, like a child's, cannot conceal his disappointment.
The next week, when Samuel returns from the provision store and empties his sack, he says, in his usual manner,
Matches, 2 is coconut oil, 3 is bitter gourd, garlic 4, Malayala Manorama,
setting the paper down as though it's another vegetable. He can barely conceal his delight when she clutches the paper to herself, elated.
Weekly it will come,
he says, proud to have pleased her. She knows that only her husband could have arranged this. Later that morning, she spots her husband not far from the house, but 10 feet off the ground, seated in the fork of a plavu, or jackfruit tree, his back against the trunk and his legs extended along the branch, a toothpick at the corner of his mouth. She's tempted to wave the newspaper to convey to him how grateful she is. She still marvels at his choosing these lofty perches instead of putting his legs up on the long arms of his charu casera. His particular chair is striking in size because it's made to his proportions. Yet it sits unoccupied on the veranda. She observes him up there. His face in profile is handsome, she thinks. A pulleyan below him and out of her sight says something that makes her husband remove the toothpick and grin, showing strong, even teeth. You should smile more often, she thinks. He yawns and stretches, adjusting his position, and her stomach turns cold. A fall from even this modest height would be devastating. Whenever she spots him so high up a distant tree that he's no more than an eccentric bump marring a smooth trunk, she cannot bear to look. Samuel says that it's from that vantage point that he reads the land, plans the direction of irrigation ditches or new paddy fields. In the evenings, after she serves dinner, and while her husband eats, she reads the Manorama to him. He never picks it up himself. The newspaper brightens her days, but it does nothing for a profound loneliness that she's ashamed to acknowledge. Tangama, who had promised to return, writes that her husband has taken ill and is bedridden, so she has put off her visit indefinitely. As for her mother, 3 monsoons have come and gone, and they have yet to see each other. Her mother tells her not to visit. Even if she wanted to, a young woman doesn't make such a journey alone. Jojo, who clings to her like a bracelet, won't go near the boat jetty, let alone climb into a boat. She suspects her husband is the same way. When her formal evening prayers are done, she converses with the Lord. I'm so happy about the newspaper. My husband clearly cares about my needs. Should I mention the other matter? I don't mean to complain, but if this is a Christian house, why don't we go to church? I know you've heard this before. If my mother could only come here, I wouldn't bother you. I could talk it over with her. Perhaps in answer to her incessant prayers, at last a letter comes from her mother after long months of silence. Samuel calls at the church on his way to the mill, and this time he comes back excitedly, holding the letter with both hands, because he knows how precious it is. His excitement is nearly a match for hers. My darling daughter, my treasure, how it warmed my heart to see your letter. You won't know how many times I kissed it. Your cousin Biji is getting married. I go to the church every day. I visit your father's grave and I pray for you. My most precious memories are with him, and then with you. What I'm saying is, please treasure each day you're in your marriage. To be a wife, to care for a husband, to have children, is there anything more valuable?
keep me in your prayers.
She revisits the letter many times in the ensuing days, kissing it each time like a sacred object. No matter how many times she reads it, it does nothing to diminish her worry. She resists the reality of life. A married woman gives up her childhood home forever, and a widow's fate is to remain in the home she married into. The calendar on the wall, a pullout from the newspaper, looks like a mathematical table, an astronomy chart. It shows lunar phases, the times each day that are inauspicious for setting out on a journey. Now it tells her this is the start of Lent, the 50-day fast leading up to Good Friday. She will give up meat, fish, and milk, but on the first day she doesn't eat even a morsel. When her husband sits down to dinner that evening, she puts the freshly cut banana leaf and the jeera water on the table. He smooths out the leaf. She frames the words she's rehearsed. Just as she opens her mouth to speak, he flattens the spine of the banana leaf with his fist. Crack, crack, startling her. He splashes jeera water on the green, mirrored surface, brushing the excess off in the direction of the mitten. The moment is gone. She quietly serves the rice, the pickle, the yogurt. Then she approaches with the meat to see if he'll wave it off on this first day of Lent. But no, he's impatient for it. What made her think this year would be different from previous years? In the days that follow, neither meat nor fish crosses her lips. She misses the companionship of a household that is fasting. But her loneliness only strengthens her determination.
You should eat more, Samuel says, halfway through Lent. You're getting too thin.
It's forward of Samuel to speak this way.
The Thambran says so. He's worried.
She feels like the people on a hunger strike pictured in the paper, camped outside the secretariat, becoming more diminished in order to be seen.
If the Thambran thinks so, he should tell me.
That night, she puts off prayers and putters around with other things. At last, when she's sleepy, she covers her head and stands facing the crucifix on the east wall of her bedroom, following tradition, because the Messiah would approach Jerusalem from the east. No prayers, no words will come to her mouth. Does God not feel her disappointment? Eventually she says, Lord, I'm not going to keep asking. You see the obstacles in my path. If you want me in church, then you must help. That's all I'll say. Amen. Thangama had said that the secret to getting what you wanted from your husband was to make a wish as you prepare jackfruit halwa. But it isn't halwa that opens the door. It's her arachi olarthiada. She prepares it in the morning by roasting and then powdering coriander and fennel seeds, pepper, cloves, cardamom, cinnamon, and star anise in a mortar, and rubbing this dry mix into the cubes of mutton to marinate. In the afternoon, she browns onions along with fresh coconut slivers, mustard seeds, ginger, garlic, green chilies, turmeric, and curry leaves, and more of the dry spice mix, then adds the meat. She flattens the fire to embers, uncovering the pot so the gravy thickens, and covers each cube of meat with a heavy, dark coating. That night, once she sends Jojo to say to his father, Choru Welambi, rice is served. She finishes the dish by refrying the meat in coconut oil with fresh curry leaves and diced coconut. She brings it out sizzling, the oil still spitting on the blackened meat's surface. Before she's done ladling it on his banana leaf, he's popped a piece in his mouth. He can't resist. She stands quietly to one side as he eats, but closer than usual. She's already read the newspaper to him in the past few nights and must await the new edition. God suddenly gives her the nerve to speak.
"Is the meat all right?" she asks. She knows it has never tasted better.
The words have left her mouth like water from the long spout of a kindi, and she watches them arrive at the cup of his ears. It's as though another human being has spoken, not she. Just when she thinks he's annoyed at her boldness, the big head sways from side to side, signaling his approval. The surge of pleasure she feels makes her want to clap, to dance. For once he sits after he finishes, not rising to rinse off his hands from the kindi. Can he hear the hammering of her heart?
Jojo, who peeks at them from behind a pillar, is astonished to hear her speak to his father. He whispers, much too loud,
"Amachi, don't tell him. Tomorrow, I promise, I'll bathe."
She clamps her hand to her mouth, but not before a giggle escapes. There's a terrible pause, and then a strange explosion. An impossibly loud and unexpected laugh emanates from her husband. Jojo emerges into the light, puzzled. When he realizes that they are laughing at him, he races up and smacks her on the thigh, crying and furious, running away before she can grab him. This only renews her husband's guffaws, and he throws himself against the back of his chair. The laughter transforms him, revealing a side of him she has not seen. He wipes his eyes with his left hand, still smiling. And words come tumbling out of her mouth. She tells him that when it was time for Jojo's bath that afternoon, she'd looked everywhere for him, eventually finding him high up in the jackfruit tree, stuck there on the plavu. Her husband's bright smile is still there. She goes on, Jojo is learning his letters and his numbers, but only if she bribes him with a treat of raw mango dotted with chili powder. She herself prefers the varietal of plantain that Samuel brought today. She hears herself prattling and stops. The crickets fill the void, and now a bullfrog joins the chorus. Then her husband asks her a question that he might have asked a long, long time ago.
Sugamano,
is everything good for you? He looks directly at her. It's the first time he studied her so intently since he stood before her in church almost 3 years ago. She tries to meet his gaze. In his eyes is a force as powerful as that of the altar in the church where they married. She recalls the line in her wedding service, "As Christ is the head of the church, so also the husband is the head of the house." Suddenly, she understands why he has kept his distance since the day of their marriage, saying little, but from afar ensuring her needs and comfort. It isn't indifference, but the opposite. He recognizes that he's someone who can so easily make her fearful. She drops her gaze. Her ability to speak has flown away. But she's been asked a question. He's waiting. Her legs feel unsteady. She has a strange impulse to go to him, to brush that knotted forearm with her fingers. It's an urge for affection, for human touch. At home, she had daily hugs and kisses, her mother's body to warm her at night. Here, but for Jojo, she'd wither to nothing. She hears his chair scrape back because he has given up on a response. She says softly, "I miss my mother."
He raises his eyebrows, perhaps unsure whether he imagined the sound.
"And it would be nice to go to church," she says in a voice that is unnaturally loud.
He seems to turn this thought over. Then he rinses his hands with the kindi, steps down to the mittim, and is gone. Her heart contracts. Foolish, foolish to have asked for so much. Later that night, once Jojo is asleep, she goes back to the kitchen to clean up and to cover the embers with a coconut husk, allowing them to survive till morning. Then she returns to the room where she sleeps with Jojo, her heart heavy.
she startled to see an open metal trunk on the floor. The stack of folded white clothing inside must belong to Jojo's mother. All she brought with her to Parambil was her wedding chata and mundu and three extra sets, all the same bright white, the traditional St. Thomas Christian woman's garb. She left behind the colorful half-saris and skirts of childhood. Her chattas are tight at the shoulders and they faintly outline her budding breasts, when the formless garment is meant to suggest that there's nothing there at all. She'd taken to wearing an oversized and threadbare chata and mundu that Thangama left behind. The chattas in the trunk, which must belong to Jojo's mother, fit perfectly. She studies herself in the mirror. Her body is changing. She's taller and has put on weight. Over a year ago, she bled for the first time. It scared her, even though her mother had warned her it would happen. She brewed ginger tea for the cramping and she fashioned menstrual clots, calling on her memory of seeing them hanging on the line. When she put her laundered menstrual cloth out to dry, she camouflaged it with towels and linen. For 4 days, she felt ill at ease, so distracted while trying to carry on. There was no one she could commiserate with, or celebrate with, for that matter. Even now, those 4 or 5 days are a great trial. At the very bottom of the trunk, she finds a Bible. "You had a Bible all these days and never told me?" She's too excited by this find to be annoyed for very long, but she resolves to mention it the next time she visits the cellar. When Sunday comes, she's surprised to find her husband in his white juba and mundu, his wedding clothes. She's so accustomed to seeing him bare-chested, his mundu half-hitched, an athorthu over his left shoulder, indistinguishable from the pulayar who work for him. Only his height and breadth set him apart, a sign that he grew up in a house where there was ample food. He calls out to Samuel,
"Ask Sarah to come stay with Jojo till we come back from church."
She races to get dressed. "Lord, I'll thank you properly once I'm in your house." They set off overland, heading the opposite direction to the boat jetty. She clutches the Bible, scurrying to keep up, taking 2 steps for each of his. She's so excited that her feet barely touch the ground. After a bit, they come to the rivulet with its single log bridge, slippery with moss.
"You go first," he says,
and she scampers over. He follows, feet planted carefully, his jaws clenched. Once across, he rests a hand on the burden stone, gathering himself before they head on. Their walk to church is much longer than if they had gone by boat. Eventually, they cross the river on a bridge wide enough for carts. The sight of people streaming into church thrills her, though she knows no one.
"I'll be waiting there," he says, pointing to a spreading pipal with aerial roots hanging down like whiskers over the church graveyard.
She's too excited to do anything but go on into the church, pulling her kavani over her head. She's forgotten what it's like to see so many at worship, to feel bodies all around, to be part of the fabric instead of a thread torn from the whole. The men are on the left, women on the right, an imaginary line separating them. She relishes the familiar phrases of the Eucharist. When the Achan raises the veil and shivers it in his hands, she feels God's presence, feels the Holy Spirit wash over her, wave after wave, lifting her off her feet. Joyful tears blur her sight. "I'm here, Lord. I am here," she cries silently. When the service is over, she comes outside and spots her husband emerging from the graveyard, his expression brooding. Excited conversation and laughter from the jetty and in the ferry boats reach their ears. They head back in silence.
"It's 5 years ago," that she died, he says suddenly, his voice laden with emotion.
Jojo's mother. It's strange to hear him speak of her with such feeling. Is it envy she feels? Is she hoping that he might speak about her one day with the same passion? She's silent, fearful that anything she says will stop the flow of words.
How can you forgive a god, he says, who takes a mother from her child?
The spaces between his sentences feel as wide as a river. This time, when they ford the log bridge, he goes first. He waits on the other side, studying his young wife, who wears the clothes of his late wife, as though seeing her for the first time.
I wish she could see us, he says, standing still. I wish she could see how well you care for Jojo, how much love he has for you. That would make her happy. I wish she could see that.
She feels dizzy from the praise, clutching the Bible that once belonged to the woman he just invoked. She is standing close to him and cranes up to see his face, feeling she might topple back. I know she can see us, she says with conviction. She could tell him why, but he doesn't need explanations, just the truth. She watches over us in everything. She stays my hand when I want to add more salt. She reminds me when the rice boils over. His eyebrows go up, and then his face relaxes. He sighs. Jojo has no memory of his mother. That's all right, she says. With her blessing, I'm his mother now. There's no need for him to remember or to grieve. They haven't moved. He peers down at her with his intense gaze. She doesn't flinch. She sees something giving way in him, as though the door to the locked ara, to the fortress of his body, has swung open. His expression turns to one of contentment. The trace of a smile seems to signal the end of a long torment. When he resumes walking, it's an easier pace, husband and wife in step. The following Sunday, he suggests she go alone to church by boat, since he's not coming. She doesn't need to make the long walk. He escorts her to the jetty, where a few other women and couples are gathered. As the boatmen pole the boat off the bank, she looks back and sees her husband standing in a cluster of areca nut trees, their narrow, pale trunks a contrast with his thick, dark one. He's rooted to the ground more firmly than any tree. Not even Damodaran could dislodge him. Their eyes lock. As the boat pulls away, she registers his expression, sadness and envy. She aches for him, a man who won't travel by water, who perhaps has never heard the sound of water parting before the prow, never felt the exhilaration of being carried by the current or the spray as the boatman's pole clears the water. He'll never know the bracing sensation of diving headfirst into the river, the roar of entry followed by enveloping silence. All water is connected, and her world is limitless. He stands at the limits of his. On her 16th birthday, she hears a commotion outside the kitchen and the excited voices of children. The ducks, clustered around the back steps, squawk and struggle to take flight, forgetting their clipped wings. She knows who it is even before she hears the clink of a heavy chain and before she turns to see the ancient eye that somehow peers in through the kitchen window. She laughs.
Damo, how did you know?
This is a new sensation, to gaze at that eye without the distraction of the immense body. She marvels at his tangled eyelashes, the delicately patterned, cinnamon-colored iris. Suddenly, she's gazing into Damo's soul, and he into hers.
She feels his love, his concern, just as when he greeted her on her first night as a bride. "Give me a moment. I have a treat for you." She's at a delicate phase in making mean waivichida. She lowers the sear fish fillets into the fiery red gravy that simmers in the clay pot. It owes its vibrant color to chili powder and its muddy consistency to the cooked-down shallots, ginger, and spices. But the key to its signature flavor is kokum, or Malabar tamarind. She must taste it repeatedly, balancing tart with salt, adding kokum water if the curry isn't sour enough, and removing kokum pieces if it's too sour. The impatient giant stamps his foot, shaking dust from the rafters.
"Stop! If my curry turns out badly, I'll tell the Thambran who's responsible."
She emerges with a hastily mixed bucket of rice and ghee. Damo's grin reminds her of Jojo at his naughtiest. Caesar, the pariah dog, dances excitedly but is careful to stay clear of the giant's feet. Damodaran pinches the lip of the bucket, lifts it from her hands, and inverts its contents into his mouth as if it were a thimble. He sweeps its edge with his tongue, then puts it down and probes with his trunk for anything he has missed. Unni, perched on Damo's neck, his bare feet hooked behind the huge ears, looks like a cat stranded up a tree. The mahout's frown is hard to see on his dark, pockmarked face, but his thick eyebrows are crossing in the middle.
"Look," Unni says, pointing to the mess on the mitten. "I tried to steer him to his spot by the tree, but no, he had to come by the kitchen first."
She leans her hand on Damo's trunk. "He came for my birthday. No one here knows, but somehow he does. God bless you for coming, my Damo." Suddenly she feels shy. She doesn't speak to her husband in such loving tones. Damo curls his trunk into a salute. When she finishes in the kitchen, she goes to Damo at his usual spot by the oldest palm. Unni has chained Damo's back leg to a stump, but it's more reminder than restraint. Damo can snap it as easily as a child breaks a twig, and he often does. As usual, every child around Parambal has come running, word having spread that Damo is home. The toddlers wear just the shiny arinyanam around the waist, not the least self-conscious about their nakedness, though wary of Damo as they hide behind the older children. She spots Jojo, one arm around the shoulder of the blacksmith's son, who is also 6 years old, but Jojo is a head taller. She stands back, observing, as intrigued by the children as by the elephant. Damo dips his trunk in the bucket of water and sprays his spectators. The little ones scatter, shrieking happily. When they regroup, he does it again. Damo is fastidious. Unlike a cow or goat, he won't eat if his excrement is lying around. If Unni wants him to stay in one spot, he must keep shoveling away whatever pushes out of Damodaran's rear end. It's a never-ending task for Unni, and endlessly fascinating to the young audience. "What's that?" the blacksmith's daughter says, pointing to the thick, crooked club hanging down from Damo's belly, its blunt end a mossy green. She's 7 years old.
"Is that another trunk?"
"No, silly," her brother says, speaking with authority, despite being a year younger than her. "It's his little Thoma."
The boys laugh. The toddlers who don't understand laugh loudest of all.
"Ha,"
the blacksmith's daughter says huffily.
"It's not so little then, is it? If you ask me, his trunk looks more like a little Thoma than that funny thing."
There's a silence as the children consider this question. The brother turns to examine the goldsmith's two-year-old grandson, a bow-legged, befuddled, and pot-bellied baby who has one finger in his nostril. All of them now study this little fellow's uncircumcised puffy penis that ends in a wrinkled pout.
Then they compare it to Damodaran's trunk. I suppose it does, the blacksmith's boy says.
Damo's swaying trunk seems to exist independently of its owner, its movements decidedly human. While his forefoot pins down a coconut branch, the pincer tip of Damo's trunk strips off the leaves in one graceful stroke. He smacks the bundled leaves against the tree to rid them of insects, then folds them onto his lip. As he chews, his trunk swings back down, but then, like a restless, playful schoolboy, he snatches the towel off Unni's shoulder and waves it like a flag before Unni snatches it back.
If only my little Thoma could do all that his trunk does, she overhears the blacksmith's boy say, I'd reach up and pluck mangoes or even coconuts.
She watches Jojo, listening intently, one hand discreetly feeling between his legs. She slips away, hand over her mouth, waiting till she's out of earshot before she collapses with laughter. That evening, she serves her husband the mean uevichida. He nods approvingly after tasting it. It will soon be 5 years, but she still worries about her cooking.
As I was making it, Damo came and put his eye to the kitchen window.
He laughs and shakes his head. Do you have ghee rice I can take to him tonight?
His expression is like Jojo's, asking for another raw mango.
But he had one bucket when he came, she says.
Oh, did he? Well, then...
But I can get more.
He looks pleased. He clears his throat.
Damo has never gone to the kitchen before. Means he likes you, he says, looking up with a shy, teasing glance.
She sets the newspaper down and heads to the kitchen to prepare the ghee rice.
Yes, I know Damo likes me. He came to greet me on my birthday. I know what he's thinking. It's you whose thoughts I never know.
When she returns with the ghee rice, her husband ignores it. With his eyebrows, he invites her to sit. He places a tiny cloth bag with a drawstring on the table before her. She pulls out two huge, heavy gold hoop earrings, intricately worked on the outside but hollow within, otherwise their weight would tear through the ear. A filigreed nut hides the post and screw. She stares in disbelief. Is she truly the owner of these kunuku? So that's why she's seen the goldsmith trudging back and forth over the last month. All her life, she's admired kunuku. They don't go into the fleshy part of the ear, but through the curling rim on top where it thins out like the lip of a seashell. She'll need to pierce the cartilage and then enlarge the hole by packing it with areca leaves until it's big enough to accept this thick post and screw. Many women wear just the post and screw. On special occasions when they connect the hoops, they project out from the ear like a cupped hand. Unlike many brides who come with jewelry as part of their dowry, all she has is her wedding ring, the tiny gold minnu that he tied around her neck in the ceremony, and two small gold studs that were hers when her ears were first pierced at the age of 5. She can't believe he remembered her birthday when he had never done so before. Now she's the one with no words. Her husband never picks up the paper, but as a farmer, he's acutely aware of dates and seasons. In the distance, she hears leaves smacking against a tree, the sound of Damo feeding. Not for the first time, she wonders if the two giants are in league. When she can bring herself to meet his gaze, her husband is smiling. He leaves without a word, taking the bucket with him. He'll sleep on the cot next to Damo while Unni heads home to visit his wife. When Damo is at Parambil, the ground vibrates with his movements. The sounds of his feeding, the snapping of branches, the crushing of leaves soothe her. But a few days later, Damodaran returns to the logging camp. Like the Thambran, he's happiest when working. In his absence, the quiet of Parambil feels exaggerated. That night, just as she's drifting off to sleep, her husband appears. She sits up, alarmed, wondering if something is wrong. His frame fills the doorway, blocking out the light. His expression is calm, reassuring. All is well. He holds the tiny oil lamp in one hand, and now he extends the other. She eases free of the sleeping Jojo, takes the proffered hand, and he pulls her to her feet effortlessly. Her fingers remain coddled in the nest of his palm as they step out. This is a new sensation, to be holding hands. Neither of them lets go. But where to? They turn into his room. Suddenly, the hammering of her heart is so loud that she's sure it echoes under the rafters and will wake Jojo. Blood surges into her limbs, as though her body knows what's about to happen, even if her mind is 5 steps behind. At that moment, she cannot know that the nights when he comes silently and leads her away will come to be so precious to her. She doesn't know that instead of her lips quivering, her body trembling as it does now, instead of her insides turning cold and her legs threatening to buckle, she'll feel a surge of excitement and pride, a longing when she sees him standing there, his hand extended, wanting her. But what she feels now is panic. She's 16. She has some notion of what's supposed to take place, even if that knowledge is inadvertent and from observing God's other creatures in nature. But she's unprepared. How exactly does it happen? If she could have brought herself to ask that question, whom might she have asked? Even with her mother, it would have been so awkward. He gently guides her to stretch out beside him on his raised teak bed. It doesn't escape him that she's frightened, shivering, on the verge of tears, and that her teeth are chattering. In lieu of spoken reassurances, he gathers her to him, one arm under her head, enfolding her, holding her, nothing more. They lie this way for a long time. Eventually, her breathing slows. The warmth of his body stops her shivering. Is this what the Bible meant? Jacob lay with Leah? David lay with Bathsheba? The night is still. At first, she hears only the hum of the stars. Then a pigeon coos on the roof. She hears the 3-note call of the bulbul. A faint scuffle in the mittim and soft padding sounds must be Caesar chasing his tail. Also, a repetitive drumming that she cannot place. Then it comes to her. It's his heartbeat, loud and almost synchronous with hers. That low-pitched, muffled thud reassures her, reminds her that she's in the arms of the man she married almost 5 years ago. She thinks of the quiet ways he's attended to her needs, from arranging for the newspaper to escorting her to church for the first time, and now walking her to the boat jetty every Sunday. He expresses his affection indirectly in those acts of caring, in the way he looks at her with pride as she talks to Jojo, or as she reads the paper to him. But on this night, during dinner, he conveyed his feelings directly, but wordlessly, through precious earrings that are the sign of a mature woman, a wise wife. This moment could have come at any time in the last few years, but he waited. After a while, he lifts his head up to look into her face. He raises his eyebrows and tilts his head questioningly. She understands he's asking if she's ready.
The truth is, she doesn't know. But she knows she trusts him. She has faith that if he brought her here, it's because he knows she's ready. For once, she doesn't look away. She holds his gaze and peers into his eyes, seeing into his soul for the first time in the 5 years she has been his wife. She nods. Lord, I am ready. He hovers over her, guides her to receive him. She bites her lips at the first sharp pain, muffling the cry that escapes. He pauses and retreats out of concern, but she pulls him down, hiding her face against the valley between his shoulder and chest so that he might not witness her shock, her disbelief at what is happening. Until that moment when he held her hand and led her to this room, they had never touched, not even by accident. Neither holding his hand nor lying in his arms prepared her for this. She feels stupid and ashamed for not knowing, for never imagining that what was supposed to unfold in its own time, as Thangama once said, meant this breach of her body, meant taking him wholly into her insides. She feels betrayed by all the women who withheld this knowledge from her, who might have better prepared her. His extreme gentleness, his consideration for her, is unnaturally paired with that first searing pain, then the dull discomfort it gives way to. His repetitive thrusts intensify, the pace quicker. How does this end? What must she do? Just when she fears he will break her, just when she wants to cry out for him to stop, his body stiffens, his back arches, and his expression becomes unrecognizable, pained, as though she inadvertently broke him. She is a naive participant and horrified observer. He tries to stifle an agonal moan, but fails and comes to a shuddering stop. He lies on her, spent, a dead weight, his skin wet with perspiration. Her thoughts are in turmoil, but she rejoices as it dawns on her that she has survived the ordeal. She has an urge to giggle at being pinned like this by his sudden helplessness. She has not just endured, but it is her body, her contribution to what transpired, that has left him robbed of all strength and rooted to her. Belatedly, as she slowly recovers her composure, she recognizes that she has blundered into full womanhood. The seconds tick by, and his weight crushes her so she can barely breathe. Yet paradoxically, she doesn't want him to move, doesn't want her feeling of power, of pride, and of ascendancy over him to end. In later years, on the rare occasions when his appearance at her door, hand extended, is inconvenient, she never refuses, because in his tender embrace and the inelegant act of what follows, he expresses what he cannot say, and what she needs to hear, and what she begins to feel now for the first time lying under him, that she's integral to his world, just as he is her world. She cannot imagine now that the pleasure she sees on his face will be something she too will experience from time to time, or that she'll unobtrusively find ways to guide him in a manner that pleases her. For now, she's so full with him, she feels he has split her in two, and yet, for the first time since her marriage, she is whole, complete. Gradually, she feels a loosening, a slackening of his grip of her insides, and at last, he rolls to one side, just his slab of a thigh over hers. His withdrawal leaves her inside smarting, leaves her exposed, and leaves a void between her legs in a place once sealed to the world. She's no longer sure of this most
intimate part of herself that feels forever altered. There's wetness trickling down her thigh. She wishes to bathe, and yet, despite the raw, throbbing pain, she's reluctant to leave, relishing the sensation of her husband fast asleep, unconscious next to her, his head nestling against her, a hand draped over her chest, much in the manner of his son. In the days that follow, she feels free to say much more to him at dinner, not just the events of the household, but her thoughts, her feelings, and even her memories, without worrying about his response. Listening is talking for him. There's an eloquence to this kind of attentiveness. It's rare, and yet he's generous with it. He alone, amongst all the people she knows, uses his two ears and one mouth in that exact proportion. She loves him in a way she didn't know she could before. Love, she thinks, isn't ownership, but a sense that where her body once ended, it begins anew in him, extending her reach, her confidence, and her strength. As with anything so rare and precious, it comes with a new anxiety, the fear of losing him, the fear of that heartbeat ceasing. That would mean the end of her. Parambil settles into its rhythm. Mouths to feed, mangoes to pickle, paddy to thresh, Easter, Onam, Christmas, a cycle she knows so well and by which she measures her days. To an observer, everything is the same. But after that night, all distance between husband and wife vanishes. Lord, thank you, she says in her prayers. I won't mention specifics. After all, what don't you know about my life on earth? But I have a question. When my husband fled the altar 5 years ago, I heard your voice say to me, I am with you always. Did you speak to him too? Did you say, turn back? Did you say, she is the one I chose for you? She waits. Because I am, Lord. I am the one. Chapter 7. A Mother Knows. 1908, Parambil. One morning, in her 19th year on earth, she wakes unrested, unable to rise, weighed down by a blanket of melancholy. Jojo tries to cheer her up, weaving her a ball from coconut fronds. Over, under, then under, over, all right? He says, forgetting who taught him. He is 10 and already taller than his Amichi, who will soon be twice his age. But whenever they are alone, he reverts to acting much younger. An anxious Jojo helps her to the kitchen, but the simple act of blowing on the embers leaves her breathless. After lunch, she retreats to her bedroom and only wakes when her husband's cool hand strokes her brow. She's shocked to see the sun is going down. She has done nothing for dinner. She bursts into tears. He sends Jojo away with a glance. Why the tears? He asks with his eyebrows. She shakes her head. He insists. You must forgive me. I don't know what's come over me. His expression says he knows there's more to it. Ever since their marriage was consummated, she confides freely in her husband, except when it comes to her mother. She's ashamed for him to know just how impoverished her life had been before her marriage. When she was 16, she'd found the courage to beg Samuel to accompany her on a trip to see her mother.
She had Samuel ask the Thumbran's permission. The Thumbran agreed. She'd use Samuel because she didn't want to put her husband into a position of saying no to her. She wrote to her mother, giving her the date of her visit. She had made up her mind that if she found her mother miserable, she would bring her back to Parambil. She could only hope her husband understood. A husband had no obligation to care for his mother-in-law. 2 days before she was to leave, her mother's letter came, emphatically forbidding her from visiting, saying it would only make matters worse. Her mother added that her brother-in-law promised that they would all visit Parambil very soon. Of course, that never happened. "I worry about my mother," she says at last, weeping, relieved to finally confess what she has kept from him. "I know in my bones she's being mistreated, even starved. After my father died, my uncle wasn't kind to us. My mother's letters talk of everything but herself. I can feel her suffering." Her husband's anvil-like hand remains on her brow, but his face is very still. The next day, he and Samuel are gone before she wakes. There's no sign of them all day, and by nightfall they have not returned. She is beside herself with worry. The following afternoon, a bullock cart jolts up the path from the boat jetty, brushing past the overgrown tapioca. Samuel sits in front with the driver. A familiar figure peers over his shoulder. She'd forgotten her mother's tall forehead and her pinched nose, both of which are exaggerated because she's so thin, her hair white, and her cheeks collapsed from missing molars. It's as though 50 years and not 8 have gone by. Her mother clutches her meager belongings, a Bible, a silver cup, and a bundle of clothes as she descends stiffly from the cart. Mother and daughter cling to each other. Their roles reversed. It's the mother returning to the safety of her daughter's arms, crying into her bosom, no longer hiding the misery of the intervening years.
"Mole,"
her mother says, when she can finally speak. "God bless your husband. At first, when I saw him, I thought something happened to you. He took one look around and he understood. Come, let's go," he said. "Mole, I was so embarrassed because your uncle wasn't pleasant, didn't even offer water. Then she pipes up behind him to say, I owed them money for breathing, I suppose. Your husband raised his finger," and she holds up a digit as if testing the wind. "Not another word," he said. "This isn't how my wife's mother should be living. I shook that dust from my feet and didn't look back." Samuel, grinning, nevertheless scolds the daughter. "Why didn't you say something to the Thumbran before? Your mother was living like the women seeking alms outside the church, just a tiny corner of the veranda for her sleeping mat." Her mother drops her head, ashamed. She says, "Your husband put us on the boat. He said he'll come another way." In the room they will soon share, she watches her mother take in the teak almara, where she can put her clothes, the writing desk, the dresser with the mirror. Her mother sees her own reflection and self-consciously tucks white strands of hair behind her ears. In the kitchen, she serves her mother tea, then quickly grinds coconut, retrieves eggs from the pantry, reheats a fish and a chicken curry, chops beans for a toran, telling Samuel not to leave before eating. "Oh, my baby," her mother says when she's served, tears trickling down her cheeks. "When have I seen meat and fish and egg together on the same leaf?" Later, her mother sits on the rope cot watching her. She grabs her daughter as she rushes to and fro.
Stop! No halwa, no laddu, nothing. I want nothing more. Just sit here and let me see you. Let me hold you, my precious.
In the way her mother looks at her, she sees how much she herself has changed. No longer the child bride her mother last saw, but the capable mother of Jojo and the mistress of Paramil. Her mother runs her fingers through her daughter's thick hair that she has missed combing and braiding. She turns her daughter's face this way and that in front of the lamp.
My little girl is a woman now.
Abruptly, her mother pulls back, her eyebrows rising as she takes in the discoloration of the cheeks and across the bridge of the nose like bat wings. Wide-eyed, she exclaims,
My goodness, Mole, you're with child.
She knows at once that her mother must be right. Perhaps it isn't strange that her heart called out for her mother now that she's to be one. At midnight, she's pacing the veranda alone, rejoicing at a reunion she dreamed about, but also praying and worrying. At 1 in the morning, she sees a distant glow from a torch made of dried, tightly bundled palm fronds. She runs to greet her husband as if he's been away for years. She can't help herself, jumping into his arms like a child and wrapping her legs around a body that feels like an overheated furnace after his 2-day march. He throws aside the torch and it sparks out against the ground. He holds her. She buries her head against him, overcome with relief. She pleads silently, never grow old, never die, knowing it's too much to ask. My rock, my fortress, my deliverer. He washes by the well. His lids are heavy as he eats dinner. He recounts his route, and she traces his circuitous path on her palm. He has walked for 18 hours and over 50 miles. He heads to his bed, too tired to even carry his lamp. She follows him past the threshold of his room. She's rarely in there without his leading her in. She lies next to him. She takes his hand and puts it on her belly and smiles at him. He's puzzled. Then, ever so slowly, understanding shows on his weary features, and he smiles. She hears a low exclamation. He squeezes her to him, but then catches himself, fearful of being too rough in his embrace. If God gave her one moment in time that she could stretch out for as long as she lives, this would be it. She hears his breathing become deeper, steady. His expression is still joyful in sleep, and his hand stays on her belly, cupping his child. In that sheltered, sacred nook between his arms and chest, she's at peace. Forgive me, Lord. She thought her prayers were unanswered, but God's time isn't the same as hers. God's calendar isn't the one hanging in her kitchen. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under heaven. It's pointless chastising herself for not rescuing her mother sooner. Happened is happened, she thinks. The past is unreliable, and only the future is certain, and she must look to it with faith that the pattern will be revealed. The girl who shivered at the altar, who now lies beside her husband, who is now with child, cannot see that one day she will be the respected matriarch of the Parambal family. She doesn't know that in time she'll earn the label with which Jojo has christened her, the first English word the little fellow learnt and at once offered her, not to tease her about being tiny, but in tribute, big. He called her Big Amachi.
She doesn't know that she'll soon be Big Amachi to one and all. Chapter 8. Till Death Do Us Part. 1908, Parambil. With the birth of her daughter, her previous life is swept away. Her body is at the beck and call of a beloved tyrant who rudely summons her from sleep, demands access, and by sheer force sucks milk from her breasts that are so swollen that she struggles to recognize them as her own. She finds it hard to remember those nights when it was just Jojo and her, sleeping, coiled together, his fingers woven into her hair to ensure that she didn't abandon him to his recurring nightmare of being adrift on the river. Was there really a time when she had three pots on the fire, one ear cocked for the hen about to lay its egg, and the other for the rustle of rain so that the drying paddy could be brought in, and all the while pretending to be a tiger for Jojo? Now she hardly leaves the old bedroom next to the ara, which they had put to use for her labor. Her connection to Parambil feels doubly cemented with a daughter who'll claim this as home, at least till she marries. Dolly Kochema, without being asked, moved in during the last stages of her confinement to help with the household tasks and with Jojo. Quiet and easygoing, Dolly never speaks of the challenges she and Georgie face. On his small plot of land, the gregarious Georgie should grow enough coconuts, tapioca, and bananas to live on, and even have a small profit, but somehow they barely get by. Samuel says it is from poor planning, along with his weakness for schemes such as planting wheat instead of rice, because it was less work, only to find wheat grew poorly and there was little market for it. Georgie must know he is a disappointment to his uncle, and so he stays away. But every morning when the baby falls asleep after her 10 o'clock feeding, Dolly Kochema oils the new mother's hair and massages her with spiced coconut oil. When Big Amachi thanks her profusely, Dolly says, "Your husband rescued us when we had nothing and I was pregnant with my first child. Jojo's mother did this for me. Now you're doing me a favor, allowing me to be of use." Dolly encourages her to go to the stream and bathe properly. "Don't worry. Baby Moll," for now the child has no name other than baby girl, "won't stop breathing in your absence." Meanwhile, her mother has taken over the kitchen. The hollow-cheeked, gray-haired woman who stepped down so gingerly from the bullock cart has a decade's worth of bottled-up thoughts to share, even if she doesn't have quite the energy she once did. Jojo doesn't understand why his Big Amachi spends so much time with the baby, or why he must be quiet when the baby sleeps. One morning, his jealousy drives him to climb high up the plavu and cry for help, as though he's stuck up the tree. When he's ignored, he's furious, and comes down, wraps his valuables in a tortu, and announces his permanent relocation to Dolly Kochema's house. Dolly and Georgie indulge him. Their children spread a mat for him next to theirs. This is how Jojo spends his first night away from Parambil, praying the place will fall apart in his absence. When word comes the next day that his Big Amachi misses him, Jojo races back, but he slows at the threshold, pretending he's returning only under duress. His mother smothers him with kisses till he's forced to give up his facade. "You're my little man. How can I go down to the cellar for pickles without you? That ghost welcomes me as long as you're there." Her little man invites his new friends over, and soon the mitten echoes with the sounds of children laughing and playing. The cacophony reminds her of her own childhood, surrounded by the constant sounds of cousins and neighbors. Thankfully, baby Moll sleeps through most anything. Now and then, while nursing baby Moll, she'll hear one of the children wailing. In the past, she'd have raced out to investigate. But now, she tells herself, a crying child is a breathing child. After a month, she moves back to her bedroom, preferring the familiarity of the bamboo mat she unrolls on its floor to the raised bed in the original bedroom next to the ara where she gave birth. Baby Moll is beside her atop a folded towel, while Jojo and her mother sleep on their mats on her other side. In the mornings, each mat is rolled up around its pillow and the bedrolls stacked on a raised ledge. Every evening, after his bath, her husband appears at the threshold of her room. Her mother, if she's there, feigns a task in the kitchen and disappears. Words may escape the mountain, but only when he's alone with his wife. His biceps bulge as he brings the bundle of cloth and flesh that is his infant to his bare chest, while the new mother marvels at the sight of baby Moll swallowed by his huge, calloused hands. "Are you eating well?" she asks.
"Yes, big amachi," he says, teasing her. "But your mother's elachi orathiada isn't as good as yours."
He isn't aware that he's paid her a compliment she cherishes. She recalls Thangama saying her brother was like a coconut, fibrous and forbidding on the outside, but with precious layers within. Its water soothes babies with gripe, while the tender white flesh is vital for every Malayali dish. That same flesh, when dried and pressed, copra, yields coconut oil. The discards from pressing copra are fodder for cattle. The hard shell makes a perfect tabi, or ladle, and the thick outer cover, when dried and spun, yields coir rope. Life would cease in Travancore without the coconut, just as Parambal would stop without her husband. But his saying her mother's erachi orathiada is not as good as yours is his way of saying that he misses her. At night, after she puts the baby to sleep, her blouse sodden and smelling of her own milk, she wonders if there are nights when her husband comes seeking her while she's asleep. Does he touch her, try to shake her awake? Or does the sight of her mother and the two sleeping children halt him at the door? The truth is, she isn't ready for him. The ordeal of labor is fresh in her memory. She was left with a tear that is finally less painful, but her body is still offering strange new embarrassments that thankfully seem to diminish with time. It will be a while before she's fully healed. Every month some story reaches her of a birth gone awry, a woman bleeding to death, or a baby stalled during its exit, an event that is fatal to mother and child. "Thank you, Lord, for bringing me through this unscathed." She doesn't share with the Lord that she misses the closeness with her husband, misses the excitement of getting on his bed, her heart pounding and hearing his heart do the same. "Well, you can't have one without the other," she says, but just to herself. There are certain things that God does not need to be told. The rhythm of Parambal is one of constancy and constant change. Jojo excitedly reports that Georgie's twin brother, Ranjan, along with his wife and three children, appeared in the night with all their worldly possessions. Big Amachi can hardly imagine Dolly's plight, with so many crammed into her tiny house. Ranjan, like Georgie, was left nothing by his father. He found a decent job as an assistant manager on a tea estate in Coorg. The pay was good, but theirs was a lonely existence in the Polibeta Hills. Something happened that caused the wife to restrain her husband with rope, throw him in a cart, and bring the family down the mountain and eventually descend on Georgie and Dolly Kochima. The wife, a stout woman with a square jaw and the habit of squeezing her eyes shut before speaking, appears formidable, more so because she wears a large wooden crucifix that would look better nailed to a wall than hanging over her bosom. She carries a Bible tightly clasped in her hand, as though fearful someone will rip it free. Dolly's children secretly call her Decency Kochima, because, according to Jojo, everything looks indecent to her. If she isn't railing against a sin the children have committed, she's railing against one they're about to commit. A few days later, Bigamichi sees the twins walking up to call on their uncle, holding hands the way close friends do. They are identical, but Ranjan looks rougher for wear. He shares his brother's boyish fidgetiness, as though an eccentric wheel turns within, producing a restless dance of his lips, eyebrows, eyes, and limbs, and affecting his gait. Both men have the same expression of unwarranted optimism, despite their circumstances. An admirable trait. They try to act solemn just before they go in to see her husband. But when they emerge, they are elated, bouncing off each other like boys let out of school. She learns later that her husband has deeded Ranjan a small, sloped, uncleared plot that sits adjacent to Georgie's. He'd probably decided on it when he first heard of his nephew's return. So now he has provided for Ranjan as well as Georgie. She admires her husband's generosity, but he struggles to match it with warmth or with the kind of wise counsel that might help his nephews be more successful. That is not his way. Jojo reports that the twins have decided to tear down Georgie and Dolly's small home and build a new joint dwelling using the best wood and good brass fittings, just the sort of house that the long-suffering Dolly Kochima deserves, but it's happening only because Ranjan and Decency Kochima are throwing in their savings. The new foundation will sit mostly on Georgie's plot, which has the well and the best drainage. Most of Ranjan's plot will go to a new approach road and to grow kapa and plantain. A shared kitchen will sit between the two wings of the house. Bigamichi can't help worrying for Dolly Kochima. Jojo has outgrown the house. Since he avoids water, he cannot challenge the other children in diving or swimming. Instead, Jojo rules the heights. Trees are his domain, and he tops the others in his daring and recklessness. He puts monkeys to shame in the way he scampers along a high branch of a tree, jumps to its neighbor, or dismounts by swinging off a vine and doing a backflip before landing on the dead leaves below. That last stunt makes him a hero to the younger children. On a Tuesday, after being confined by 2 days of rain, the older children race outside to swim in the river. Only the toddlers are there for an audience as Jojo clambers up a tree, grabs a vine, and swings out. But his hands slip off the wet vine, throwing off his backflip. He's leaning too far forward when he lands, his momentum forcing him to race forward before he falls face down into a shallow drainage ditch filled with rainwater. The toddlers applaud the splash and the added comical touch of Jojo choosing not to stand up and instead to thrash in the puddle like a hooked fish. The little ones are in hysterics, clutching their bellies. That Jojo, the things he can do. but they get bored when Jojo doesn't get up, and they gradually drift away.
Jojo is hiding in the water and he won't play,
one of them reports to Big Amachi. Lulled by feeding baby Mol, she smiles. Seconds later, she rips the baby off her nipple. Its arms fly to both sides, as if to break a fall. She puts the baby down.
What water?
She screams.
Show me. Where?
The child is startled but points in the direction of the irrigation ditch, and she runs. She sees Jojo's shoulder blades and the back of his head cresting the water, his hair wet and glistening, hair that's such a struggle to wash. She leaps into the turbid ditch, jarring her spine because of its unexpected shallowness. It barely reaches her knees, and flips him onto the ground. She pushes on his stomach, and mud surges out of his mouth. She cries,
"Breathe, Jojo!"
Then she screams,
"Ayo, Jojo, for God's sake, breathe!"
The sound pierces the air, and it carries for a mile. She hears footsteps pounding over wet leaves. Her husband slides down to her on his knees. He squeezes his son's ribcage, pushes on the belly. Samuel arrives, breathless, and kneels across from the pair, reaching into Jojo's mouth to sweep out mud and more mud, but still he doesn't breathe. Georgie suspends Jojo by the ankles while Ranjan pumps Jojo's arms up and down and water pours out, but he won't breathe. Ranjan covers Jojo's lips with his and blows into his lungs as Jojo hangs upside down, his arms alongside his ears like a fish being weighed. They lay him down and take turns breathing into his mouth, thumping on his back, pushing on his belly. She circles them like a mad woman, tearing at her hair, crying out in disbelief, screaming at them, "Don't stop! Don't stop!" But Jojo, stubborn in life, is more stubborn in death, and will not breathe for her, or his father, or Samuel, or all the others who try. He will not breathe to save their broken hearts. Their efforts seem to be violating his limp body. At last, her husband pushes them away and holds his son to him, groaning, his body shaking. She registers a distant shrill wail that empties a pair of tiny lungs, then a gasp for air, then another shriek. She has completely forgotten baby Mol. If you're crying, that means you're alive. She backs away, afraid to leave Jojo. She runs back to her room and picks up the infant. She lifts her chatta, shoves a nipple at the baby, alarming it by her brusqueness, making it only wail more. She studies the infant's face, the bared gums, the ugly mask of its discontent. She resents its blind need for her teat. At last it latches on. With the baby at her breast, she stumbles out to see her Jojo, her faithful shadow and companion for 8 of his 10 years. Her little man lured down on the veranda bench by his father, the boy's belly grotesquely distended. Her shattered husband turns and leans his raised arms against a pillar as if to push it down, but the pillar is the only thing keeping him upright. The expression on Jojo's face is one of puzzlement. She squats by her son, her hand on his cold forehead, and she wails. Baby Mol's eyes roll up in fright, and she bites sharply on the nipple. "Lord," Big Amachi thinks, "I'll willingly trade this new life if you give me my Jojo back." This thought shames her into a measure of sanity. She reaches out to her husband, still chained to the pillar, as silent in grief as he is in joy. Chapter 9. Faith in Small Things. 1908, Parambil. Drowning on land is how she thinks of it. In its aftermath, she has a recurring nightmare. She's carrying her children, her mother, and her husband on her head, staggering under the weight, in danger of sinking into the soil if she stops moving, mud filling her mouth. When she arrives at the burdenstone, the horizontal slab is on the ground, useless. She looks up and down the road for help, but she's alone. Somehow, she goes on, so that Parambil can go on. If her father were there, he'd encourage her to be faithful in small things. Nothing ruffled him, not even his own suffering. But she resists this verse. She's furious with her God.
How can I be faithful in small things if you can't be faithful in big ones?
She's surprised to feel anger towards her grieving husband. It builds within her. At first, like a hornet's nest, it's no more than a fleck of mud in a wooden joist. But it grows, and portholes appear, and soon a steady drone can be heard within. She prays for her fury to be lifted. She prays even though God has failed her, because what else can humans do in such circumstances but pray?
I've never seen his lips touch toddy. No one can accuse him of sloth or miserliness. He has never hit me and never would. Lord, he doesn't merit my wrath. He lost his child too. Why do I feel this way?
She goes to his room after his bath, entrusting the baby to her mother. At this hour, just before dinner, he's often recumbent, his hand draped over his forehead, as if the act of bathing exhausts him. She recognizes his mannerisms, but never truly knows what they signify. To her surprise, he isn't lying down, but seated on the bed, his shoulders back, his head up, as if he expects her and has steeled himself for what must come.
I need to know, she says simply, standing in front of him, their faces on the same level.
He tilts his right ear to her. She's been aware for a while that he hears poorly, but his silence makes it less obvious. She says it again. He watches her lips to see if there's more.
Any other man would have said, "Know what?"
But not him. She doesn't wait.
I need to know about...
She wrings her hands in exasperation.
About the condition.
She has just christened it. Surely that's the first step. She's named this thing that she has sensed from the time the marriage was proposed. The whispers about drownings running in the family, the house built away from water, his distaste for rain, his strange way of bathing, the very things that afflicted their son. The condition. You can't ask how to hunt a snake if you don't have a name for it. He doesn't feign ignorance, but he doesn't move. Seated, he's still taller than she is. But to her, their age gap feels narrower than ever.
For our daughter's sake, she says, so I can protect her, and for the other children we'll have, God willing, I need to know what you know. Why was Jojo so fearful of water? Why won't you, my husband, get on a boat? Does baby Maul have the condition too?
He stands up, towering over her, and her heart races. He's never come close to threatening her. She braces herself. But he steps past her to reach up and retrieve a parcel wedged on the ledge just under the ceiling. It's wrapped in cloth and tied with a string. He holds it outside the door and shakes off the dust.
It was hers, he says, as though that's sufficient explanation.
He sits beside her and unwraps the disintegrating coarse hemp cloth around it,
The second layer is the cloth of a fine coverney. She gets the scent of a bygone era, and of another woman, the same scent that is in the cellar at times, and that was on the stored garments he gave her when he first took her to church. Jojo's mother. On top of the pile is a gauzy, transparent cotton pouch that she can see holds a wedding ring, as well as the minnu, the tiny gold pendant in the shape of a tulsi leaf, with gold beads forming a crucifix on its surface. He tied this around his departed wife's neck when they married, just as he tied her own minnu around her neck on their wedding day. He moves the pouch aside and hands her a small square sheet, Jojo's baptismal record. She's wrenched with guilt seeing this, as though at this moment she's breaking the news to Jojo's mother of her son's death. She fights back tears. She doesn't dare look at her husband. Her anger has vanished. Now his big hand lifts out a folded wad of papers, crumpled at the edges. The silver fish have chewed at the corners, while the paper beetles have made crescent-shaped fenestrations through it. Gingerly, he unfolds the fragile parchment. It is an outsized map or chart, made up of papers glued on their long sides, but the rice paste glue, so delicious to silverfish, is largely eaten away. He spreads it out over both their laps. The writing is faded. A few more years and these papers will be just dust. A tree. The thick, dark trunk is crooked, and on the branches are a few leaves. The leaves have names, dates, annotations. She recalls a similar genealogy drawn by her father. She sat on his lap as he explained.
Matthew gives us the genealogy of Jesus beginning with Abraham, 14 generations to David, then 14 from David to the Babylonian captivity, and another 14 from the exile to the birth of Jesus.
Her father was convinced Matthew had omitted two generations.
He was a tax collector. He liked the symmetry of 14 repeated thrice, but it's inaccurate.
The tree on her lap lacks symmetry and is devastatingly accurate. She understands at once that it is a catalogue of the malady that has shattered the Parambal family. But, unlike Matthew's gospel, this is a secret document, hidden in the rafters, to be viewed only by family members, and only when they absolutely must see it. Did it take the loss of their son for her to earn the right to this knowledge? She's had a child with this man. They are bound by blood. Yet he kept this from her. She brings the lamp as close as she dares. Surely this fresher writing that recorded Jojo's birth must be Jojo's mother's. Why was she allowed to see this? Did she already know of the condition and ask? Other hands, some old and tremulous, as evidenced by the hitches in the loops, coils, and uprights of the Malayalam script, have laboriously penned entries too. Perhaps her husband's mother or his grandmother, and someone else before that and before that. There are also smaller slips of ancient, coarse paper inside the folded map. He peers over her shoulder, his hands clenched. Using Jojo's name printed on a branch as anchor, she sees that the Parambal lineage goes back at least 7 generations, not counting the slips of paper, and forward too. She's entering unfamiliar backwaters. The past is as murky as the ghostly faint ink, the crumbling paper. The ancestral family boasts slave traders, 2 murderers, and the apostate priest Patros. It says so here. Next to one name she reads, just like his uncle, but younger. She struggles to decipher the letters so closely crammed together, and so never married. An annotation next to a Papachin, three generations before her husband, says, his father, Zachariah, also deaf and staggered when eyes closed, from the age of 40. A loose note says, boys suffer more often than girls. Watch for exuberant children, fearless except for water. By the time they are taken to the river, all you mothers will know. They're describing Jojo. Which mother wrote this warning? She turns back to the tree, to a symbol that recurs on some branches. What are these squiggles under this strange crucifix? She asks.
Are they not words? He says, softly.
She turns to him, stunned. For the longest time, she has read the paper to him at the dinner table, but has never seen him read. She assumed he never cared to. He cannot read. How could she not know this till this moment? The innocence of his question reminds her of Jojo when she first met him, and she fights back tears. She shakes her head. No, it's not words. He says,
then it looks like water with a cross.
She is in awe of her husband. He is illiterate, yet he saw it for what it was, just as he might see a dusting of mold on a tree trunk. True, she says softly, a cross over water, a sign they died by drowning.
He says, is Shantama there, my father's older sister?
She finds her and points. The cross on water is by her name.
She drowned before I was born.
Which grief-stricken mother thought up this symbol? Under the dancing flame of her lamp, the crucifix atop the wavy lines also resembles a denuded tree at the head of a fresh mound of dirt, a grave. There's a death by drowning every generation, she says, tracing with her finger. A few of the crosses have annotations, and she reads aloud. In the lake, the stream, the Pamba River. Her husband points with his chin in the direction of their sorrow.
Irrigation ditch.
It will be her task to write those words. How much did the marriage broker know about the condition? What about her mother or uncle? Did they know and conceal it from her? Or dismiss it? But of course, her husband knew. She doesn't want to hate the man she loves, but she has to get it off her chest. I wish you'd told me what you knew, she says. We could have protected Jojo, forbidden him from swinging on those things, climbing trees, so...
No,
her husband says, so vehemently that she almost drops the papers. He stands. She's seen this kind of anger directed at others, but never at her.
No, that's what my mother did. Kept me on the property, a prisoner, when all I wanted to do was run, jump, climb. And after my mother died, Thangama and my brothers did the same. When I look at this, I can only see squiggles, he says, jabbing the papers with a finger. You know why? She never let me go to the church school because it was across the river. She didn't even want me to walk next to it. What I know now is there's always a way to get somewhere. It's just longer. My brothers and sisters have no problem with water. They went to school. Once I ran away, my brothers and Thangama locked me up. Out of love, they claimed. But it was out of fear. Out of ignorance.
His tone softens.
My mother
and Thangama meant well. They wanted to protect me, like you wish to with our Jojo. But it made me weak. My brother cheated me because I couldn't read.
He's pacing the room.
Believe me, no one had to tell me or Jojo to stay away from water. If we can't swim, we can do plenty of other things. We walk, we climb. Do you think I don't mourn my only son? But if I had the chance to do it again, I'd change nothing. Jojo wasn't on a leash. My son lived like a tiger the few years he had on this earth. He climbed. He ran fast. He made up for the one thing he could not do.
His voice breaks. He gathers himself and goes on.
I didn't hide it. I assumed you knew. Your uncle certainly knew. I'm sorry if you didn't. You only had to ask. But I don't go around with a bell like a leper to announce it. This is a part of me. Like the goldsmith's wife whose face is scarred by smallpox. Or the potter's son whose foot is turned. This is me. This is who I am.
She's forgotten to breathe. He's said more words of significance in one evening than in their last 8 years together. The crowd that is within him, small boy, father, and husband, rage and grieve together. His expression softens.
You could have married better.
She reaches for his hand, but he pulls away and leaves the room. Her mind is in a whirl. Thus far, nothing suggests Baby Mall has any fear of water. Even if Baby Mall doesn't have the condition, she'll be considered tainted, capable of passing on this bad seed. With a shaking hand, she records the year Jojo's mother died. She draws a new branch arising from her husband's name. She writes in her name and the date of her marriage, then a branch from their union, where she writes Baby Mall. She will have Baby Mall baptized before she is 6 months, and then she will enter her proper name and birth date. How many branches will lead down from Baby Mall once she marries?
I'm on the inside now, Lord, she says. The condition is mine as much as it is his. How can I cast blame?
Under Jojo's name, she writes the year of his passing. She draws the three wavy lines, easy enough to do with her trembling fingers. How cruel, how viciously unfair that Jojo should die from the one element he worked so hard to avoid. Atop the wavy lines, she draws the cross which looks like a tree on the hill of Calvary, the three points breaking into sub-branches reminiscent of the St. Thomas cross, but also looking like tree branches that have been cleaved off, leaving the pointy ends clawing at the sky. She grieves now with Jojo's mother.
I know he was yours, but he was mine too, and I had him longer. I loved him so much.
Her pen touches the paper, struggling to fit the loopy shapes and tails.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.